if I pronounce that correctly. She's the chair of Students Nova Scotia, and this is Kyle Power, who was the chair last year. So, who's a guy? Dal student, right on. So I can just pass it over to you folks, and away you go. Thanks for coming.
Okay, thanks very much. I'm going to go through a presentation. Basically, I'll talk about what Student Centers has been doing in the past couple of years, and then kick it to Amy to kind of talk about further, I guess, on that. So generally, about Students NS, who are we? We're the primary provincial advocacy group for students in Nova Scotia. We represent almost 90% of university students in the province. We've started representing community college students recently for the first time. We have 8 members. We've actually added 2 members in the past year, and 1 a referendum and a 3rd. And we're an advocacy organization for students. I've often heard us called kind of a lobbying organization. I've never taken to kind of being called a lobby organization because I think that's probably doesn't capture the scope of what we do. And also the kind of lobbying message is like you sit down with politicians all the time and talk to them about issues or something. We don't actually meet as often with politicians as you might suspect. We take a lot of other approaches. So kind of a general overview of what we do. We represent Nova Scotia students by researching the challenges they face, finding solutions for those challenges, and then creating political space for those solutions to happen. This is generally has long been the mandate. Again, it's somewhat expanded in the past year, and I think you'll get a sense of that from the rest of the presentation in terms of us providing additional services and undergoing other activities beyond the scope of kind of strictly put advocacy or lobbying. And we work around 4 values that are defined by our members. 1 is access. Everybody should be able to access post-secondary education if they're qualified. Affordability, the cost of post-secondary education shouldn't stop you from doing what you want to do with your life. Quality, as in your post-secondary education should meet your expectations and support your lifelong success with respect to not only kind of your career, but your citizenship and your personal well-being, your health. So generally, I love to put an aspiration chart, and student voice, sorry, is students' participation in decision-making as a goal in and of itself. So we like to talk about kind of our organizational aspiration. On the one hand, to have an engaged student community. On the other hand, to be a major contributor to understanding post-secondary education. And on the third side, to have policy impact for students, so to generate concrete results that are benefiting students. And within that, to be a national model for how a student organization can succeed. So I'm going to talk a bit about results, so how we're doing on kind of having concrete results for students. Our top focus area has traditionally been student financial assistance. Many people might not realize about 25% of university students that are Nova Scotia residents in Nova Scotia are middle or low income. So generally speaking, the population that attends post-secondary education is a higher income population. We have traditionally emphasized, because of that, targeted assistance based on financial need. Student assistance program delivers the most support to those lower income and middle income students, and then it does support higher income students, but incrementally less. It's the best mechanism to make sure that the most money is getting to the students who need it the most based on how much they need to get to school. And it's the best approach to reduce debt because it's going to give money to the people that have the most debt the most. And we've had a lot of success on this priority. Last year, we had a government that was looking at closing a $350 million budget deficit, and yet we secured the second largest social policy investment in that budget. And it continued improvements that have taken place now over 4 years, because there'll be another investment in the student assistance program this year to eliminate interest on student loans. But that will make it a $25 million investment in student assistance program in 4 years. That's almost a doubling of the student assistance budget in Nova Scotia. It's a doubling, more than a doubling, of the proportion of money coming from student assistance that comes in grant form as opposed to loan form. It's a substantial increase well beyond inflation in the maximum amount of money that you can access through student assistance. It's a reduction in the amount that you'll have to pay back if you work. It's more money you'll get for your books. It includes a debt cap, where if you complete your undergrad in 4 years, or if you complete it in 5 years, for the first 4 years of your undergrad, your loans from the Student Assistance Program in Nova Scotia will be all converted to grants. So you'll have none of that money to pay back. And the last 2 years is about $10 million of this amount. And we know for a fact that that money would not have been invested in the Student Assistance Program if not for the advocacy of students in Nova Scotia. So that's our top priority area, but we had results in a number of other areas as well. So this year we had a pre-election document that we circulated to the parties, and the Liberal Party, which won the election, pulled two policies directly from that document and committed to implementing them in the election. One of those was removing interest on student loans, which they've committed to do this year. The other was to introduce Nova Scotia graduate scholarships akin to the OGS in Ontario. I have since had conversations with senior bureaucrats in government that were asking us how the program is supposed to work because they didn't know how it worked because we're the ones that designed it. And they were trying to figure out how that was supposed to be implemented because it did come out of our policy. We've opposed differential tuition regulations for out-of-province students. That's this past year. We have supported the minimum wage being tied to the low-income cutoff and reaching one of the highest rates in Canada. It used to not be among the highest rates. We supported Election Act amendments that meant that you could vote where you went to school, even if you came from a different place, even if you weren't married, because before you had to be married, or else you wouldn't be able to vote, say if you were at Dalhousie and you came from Yarmouth. They would want you to go back to Yarmouth to vote. And the province is preparing an international education strategy pursuant to a recommendation in a report that we released last spring. And then just last week, we released a review of student union policies and practices around sexual assault prevention. And the province responded by committing to have sexual assault nurse examiners in Cape Breton and in southwest Nova Scotia, you know, in Annapolis Valley or on South Shore, which was pursuant to a recommendation in that report. Something a lot of people have been asking for a long time, so we definitely don't take full credit on that, obviously. Some very significant groups have been asking that for a long time, but we were happy that the ultimate commitment did come out of, or come in response, I guess, to a report that Student Senate has put out. And we're anticipating more is going to happen in the next 6 months to a year. There is an MOU negotiation, which is agreement between the government and the universities that kind of sets the direction of the system. That agreement will be reached in the next year. We're expecting to make gains in that agreement, but there's other policies that are likely to be implemented in the next while. So media coverage. We like to talk about media coverage as another area where we're delivering value. We're at about 100 and something hits a year. We tried to go back and do an analysis of this, and we don't track everything. But 2012, we had 79 media hits, and then that was the media hits that we make available on our website, but there were additional media hits that we don't have a link for, or we didn't track down. So you're looking approaching 100, especially when you consider kind of the coverage that we had last week in response to our sexual assault prevention review. So notably on that, Amy Brierley was on Information Morning on the Monday morning. We had two appearances on Global Television. We had two appearances on CTV, including CTV National. We were on CBC television, we were on CBC radio, I think another two times, Radio Canada. Basically, we were all over the place, very positive coverage. And I've put up there what I could kind of quickly find in terms of where there were media hits for students on us. Another thing that's kind of related to both results and I think, you know, media response was last year, we provided a lot of direct support to Dalhousie in the context of the budget development process that the university went through. Last January, the university kind of came out of nowhere and said, oh, we have a deficit worth $1,000 for every student at the university, $17.5 million. And this was kind of projected as something that was inevitable, that it just happened, that they couldn't plan for. And we provided financial analysis to the DSU directly. And we ultimately released the press release featuring Jeremy Aaron, who was the president of the DSU last year, at the lead of that press release, kind of commenting on this statement about where the finances were at Dalhousie, calling for more financial transparency, calling on the university not to pass the buck on to students and calling for students to participate more in decision making. And we had some results in the sense that international tuition, which is deregulated, did not increase more than the domestic student tuition, so there weren't differential increases for international students. There weren't differential increases for professional students, to my recollection. Admittedly, I could be wrong about that, but I was fairly certain. And Dalhousie somehow discovered that its budget deficit wasn't as bad as was projected, which they have done systematically, as was shown by a Dalhousie Faculty Association report last year that showed that they systematically underestimate their revenues so that they could reallocate money into buildings. So I'm going to talk a bit more about Students NS. Students NS, about less than 2 years ago, received a doubling of fees from most of the members. SMU passed a doubling of fees last year, following all the other universities, with a 75% vote in a referendum. That moved us kind of from a core funding model of around $90,000 to around $200,000. We went from having one full-time staff person to having five. For this fall, we had five full-time staff. Right now, we have four full-time and three part-time. With that money, I mean, basically, we went through a rebranding process with that. This is a different organization. Students Nova Scotia, really, as it currently exists, as this organization has only been around for about 17 months. It's a very new organization. It's a very young organization. There is a longer history in terms of the Alliance of Nova Scotia Student Associations, which is the organization's previous name, but the real structure has only been around for quite a short period of time. I think of this birth date of this organization being August 1st, 2012, or I guess 2013, when we hired our first full-time staff other than the executive director. And so last year we passed the strategic plan. We've conducted a full internal governance review. All the policies of the organization are new as of last year. We are establishing the policy base for the organization's advocacy, and that's a multi-year process to get to know the issues that are affecting students in the province. I'm going to talk a bit more about that later. And we've built new engagement structures and campaigns, and we've had a lot of growth in our membership in the meantime, and our membership continues to grow, it seems. So I'm going to talk a bit about our annual plan for this year. What I've got in bold there, the stuff I'm going to talk about, some of it I'm going to leave out because I've covered it already. One of our top priorities is to improve representation. We developed the student assemblies model, which is, to my knowledge, the first kind of model that's entrenched in governance in an organization of our kind in Canada, and I could be wrong about that. I know that there are general assemblies within Quebec. I don't know how they're built into our structures, but we've built in kind of an expectation among our members that our members expect each other to host student assemblies twice a year so that they can collect input into student Nova Scotia policy. And we've scheduled regular release of policy in draft form for about a month so that basically you can host those events on your campus to collect feedback on the proposals that we're making so that our policy is reflecting the values of our students. We've run a Mend the Gap campaign recognizing our underrepresentation of women. And we've released the first report in Canada, to my knowledge, again, that explores kind of what are the numbers in terms of women's representation in student politics at our campuses, and we did find that there was a significant gap in terms of lower representation of women. I know that there's somebody here from Acadia. Acadia has the highest representation of women in the province, but they still have work to do. We host something called Leader Lab, where we train our student union executives each year and those students that want to attend in art of hosting techniques so that they can host our kind of student assemblies. And interestingly, Leader Lab and student assemblies are really products, to my mind, of Jamie Aaron, who's the DSU president last year, in terms of those being really critical priorities for him to get those skills into the executives so that the executives could do better engagement with their students and make sure the students were driving the organization. And we've worked with the community college system to try and have representation for community college students in those sessions. We've done a lot of work on policy and research. I put in bold the reports that we've already completed. But we've undertaken a lot of initiatives. This is what I'm talking about in terms of building the baseline research or policy of the organization. And you see that there are a lot of aspirations there. Not all of them do we expect to get covered in 1 year, or else we'd run ourselves ragged. The position papers that we have released, I'm going to talk about a bit more later. We've also contracted out other reports. So we secured $45,000 from the province, from about, you know, within that money, about $13,000 from our member student unions to conduct reviews of student union policies and practices around alcohol risk reduction and around sexual assault prevention. So basically to provide student unions with advice so that when you're elected in May of each year and you're like, oh, I know I have to work around alcohol and I know I have to work on sexual assault prevention, but I don't know very much about these issues, I don't know what I should be doing. Well, we've created resources that you can go to that explain to you the issues very clearly. They provide you the best evidence available for the kind of the extent of the problems on our campuses and generate a lot of ideas for how you can take action to address those issues. So we released the first one of those reports last week, and that's what I was talking about before. It was very, very well received. And we had a steering committee for that project comprised of a representative from the Women's Center, the Anti-Aggression Women's Resource Center, the SMU Women's Center, the Sexual Diversity Center at CBU, Amy Brierley, who's their chair and a former equity officer, an equity officer at Acadia. So a very representative group. And we also consulted with Venus Envy to get feedback on how we could make sure that we were delivering a good quality report that was reflective of students' values and progressive. And kind of in response to our research quality, Alex Usher, who's not somebody that we always agree with, but he is, generally speaking, one of the most respected commentators on post-secondary education policy in the country. Last year called Students Nova Scotia the Student Organization of the Year by Country Mile in response to one of our policy reports on international students. So we've gained recognition across the country for the quality of our research reports. I was speaking with the deputy minister here in Nova Scotia, and she'd read one of our reports on university accountability, and she was telling me that the deputy minister for advanced education in Ontario had also been reading that report, and that they'd found it really interesting and useful. And I know that our reports are being used by university staff as a tool in orientation when they begin their positions. These are some of the campaigns that we've been working on this year, and this is something that we've built a lot this year, with the additional resources. A lot of that, you know, we have sort of $200,000 in core funding. We've secured about $150,000 in additional funding for other projects. A lot of that money is streamed into what we've sort of called our campaigns priorities. So we've delivered a lot of media commentary. I've talked a lot about that. We created election questionnaires that our student unions could use to kind of ask questions to leaders, maybe send out a questionnaire and then publish it in your student newspaper, all of that kind of during the election process. We also use those to create an evaluation document on the parties, which we then provided to our student unions to circulate to students so that they could kind of understand what were the issues, what were the commitments from the parties to work on those issues. And those handouts were approved by our board of directors in terms of any evaluation that was provided. We are developing an employer award. We had a meeting recently. We secured about $10,000 so far from the provincial government to do this. We're partnering with the provincial government, Greater Halifax Partnership, the Halifax Region Municipality, and a number of other kind of business associations in developing this award. And the idea is that we've been, frankly, shitting on businesses for not kind of helping students get over the experience gap. I can't get a job because I haven't got experience, and I can't get experience because I can't get a job. And we wanted to be able to not just kind of throw stones, but be able to say, these are the companies that are doing things right, that are leaders, that are training employees well, that are giving young people benefits, the whole kind of nine yards. We are hosting a Youthful Economy Summit. We've secured about $25,000 approximately from a number of partners, including Dalhousie, including Democracy 250 Trust, to host that event here at Dalhousie. We're excited to be doing that with the Dalhousie Student Union this March. And we've secured a few speakers to come to that, notably Andrew Longille from Youth, and he writes a blog called youthandwork.ca, and a guy named Paul, what's Paul's last name? Anyway, his organization is called GenerationSqueeze.ca, really fascinating organization that works on kind of the challenges young people face when you get out into the economy and you're trying to start a family, you're trying to buy a home. I'm going to go through the rest a bit quickly. Youthful Wellness Student Wellness Conference is about sexual assault prevention, alcohol risk reduction, building on the reviews that we're doing and trying to bring together executives from this year with executives from next year so that any lessons are learned are not lost in the transition. And we also hosted a mental health conference this past Monday with a number of partners. And we have a sexual assault prevention campaign that's funded by the province. I actually have the comps in the back today for kind of messaging for a few different options on what it could be. It's generally going to be a consent message, enthusiastic consent. No means no. Like, no is not, the bar is not high enough at no means no. You actually have to have a meaningful yes. So yes is not enough. It has to be enthusiastic. Students Speak Out is a campaign that I'll talk a tiny bit at the end. And we've wanted to expand partnerships a lot this year, and it's something we've worked on. So we've been working with the Affordable Housing Association of Nova Scotia. We've been working with the Anishinaabemowin Resource Center, GenerationSqueeze.ca, the MSCC, Dalhousie, Department of Labor and Advanced Education, a number of different organizations to kind of push forward the initiatives that we're working on. And it's been really positive. So last thing I want to go through is some Students NS policy stuff. So there's a couple of our report covers. We are primarily, I think, you know, at the core, a lot of our operations are kind of on the think tank model. Right now, we've got 4 full-time staff. Two of them are full-time researchers, broadly speaking, both kind of masters in public policy, masters in public administration grads. So this is a bit of work that we did in trying to figure out what's the enrollment going to look like in Nova Scotia, and I don't know if this kind of model has been published anywhere else publicly, but this is basically the kind of model that all the universities are operating on. In blue, you see 2011-12 enrollment, and then we went to 2031-32 and tried to figure out what the university system would look like. For the domestic population, so Nova Scotia students, out of province students, we've assumed that we keep the same proportion of the student demographic, so the traditional university age demographic, coming to Nova Scotia universities. And then basically we've filled in the gaps with international students. And what you come to as a conclusion is that because of our demographic decline in Nova Scotia, we would project that you're going to be looking at a university system that looks entirely like St. Mary's in the sense that you have 30% international students at every university in Nova Scotia to keep the system the same size by 2031-32. So that's kind of a contextual thing to think about in terms of our university system, that we're going to become much more international moving forward. We've done some work on fairness in university funding. We tried to start this project. Okay, how much money do you need to give to a university in Nova Scotia to operate? And ultimately, we came to the conclusion that you can't fund a system like that. You have to fund the system based on the capacity of the funders to pay for that system. And so where we've been at the moment is a recommendation to freeze tuition at 0% growth. So that's a real tuition reduction relative to inflation, a nominal tuition freeze, until the economy recovers to pre-recession levels, and then it can go at inflation, so a real tuition freeze. We've recommended that government funding be tied to the growth in the economy, so the growth in government revenues at the top, or if government revenues aren't growing, then just tie it to inflation so that at least they're getting inflationary funding growth. And we've recommended to give students control over approval of increased or new ancillary fees. You should have the choice of whether or not you're going to pay a fee for a new service. I put in bold, kind of innovative, new ideas that I haven't seen anywhere else that came out of Students NS. We recommended tying international student tuition to their cost to educate. So the amount that a university receives for a domestic student in the same program from tuition and funding, which would equate approximately at this time to a freeze at inflation, basically international student tuition. Not exactly certain exactly what that would look like. But at the same time, we've advocated for a 5% reduction over 5 years, so 1% a year in differential fees for international students, but not a reduction across the board, a targeted reduction for the students who need it the most. Wipe it out. So if you're a student with financial need, you don't have a differential fee to come to Nova Scotia. And we've talked about an English language guarantee which is something that kind of came out of an idea in Alberta, where if you don't graduate and you get, or out of Saskatchewan, if you don't graduate and get a job, the university pays your tuition to do employment training for 6 months. Well, we've argued that what should be happening in Nova Scotia is universities should take some responsibility for the language education of their international students. If you graduate, when you graduate as an international student, and English isn't your first language, we'd like the university to provide you, or the government, free of cost, the language exam that's required to be able to immigrate to Canada. And if you don't get the passing grade that you need to immigrate to Canada, then the university should be on the hook for up to 6 months of English language upgrading. Just the tuition, not your living costs, but English language upgrading for 6 months, and then you get the exam again. And if you don't pass it again, it's not the university's problem. But if you, you know, if you haven't passed the first time, it is the university's problem, and they're responsible for that. So that's an idea that I haven't. That was basically a Students NS idea, and that got some attention, notably from McLean's, in a national kind of piece that they did. We did a report recently on student financial assistance. We've been pushing for student loans to be converted to grants. If you reallocated the funding that we're putting into tax credits for students that largely go to low higher income students, largely benefit you after you graduate or at the end of the year, then we could fund massive improvements to the student assistance program that would be targeted at people with the greatest financial need. So they would allow you to convert all provincial student loans to grants. You wouldn't have any more loans if you're going to a public institution in Nova Scotia. They would eliminate the maximum assistance amount. We would meet your need, whatever your need was, for student assistance. It would be met. There wouldn't be a maximum amount. And it would end discrimination against married students. We ran some numbers in terms of what the contributions would be for spouses and parents. And on approximately $60,000 a year, if you're a single parent with one child, that parent would be expected to contribute 3% to their child's education. A spouse with one partner would be expected to contribute almost half of their income towards that partner's education. It's basically discriminatory that they're giving a certain quality or standard of living to one person and not to another. And we've also asked the lower expected parental contributions. So reduce the amount that your parents would have to contribute at, you know, across the income scale to recognize that they need to spend money on other priorities like an RRSP, an RESP, or just have discretionary income. And then we have an off-campus housing report that we released. Well, we haven't released, actually. So you're getting an early view. Sorry, making sure I get the... and it's had a few different ideas. I'm losing my voice. Notably, to expand housing supplies for students through different partnerships involving universities, the government, maybe the private sector. One idea is maybe to have a student housing cooperatives or a student housing organization that would construct student housing and be run by student unions in partnership with each other and in partnership with the public sector. We talked about collecting damage deposits centrally so that landlords can't hold on to the damage deposit at the end and you don't have to go to court or the appeals committee to try and get your money back. And we talked about a program whereby if your landlord is not doing basic maintenance on the property, you can call a handy person service. They'll come and do the maintenance on your property, and then potentially they could bill your landlord through the property taxes for the cost of the repairs, so that landlords are more responsible to do the repairs that they're responsible for under the Tenancy Act. So I guess the last thing I'm going to talk about is Students Speak Out. This is a campaign that we've launched. I think it's the second time we've done it. It's a video with interviews with students across the province who have significant amounts of debt about their experiences with debt, the financial challenges that they're facing, and then we've got a petition to the provincial government that we're hoping to get more signatures on, asking the government to make the changes to the student assistance program that we've asked for to freeze Nova Scotia students' tuition and to give students control over the approval of new fees, ancillary fees like your athletics fee and so on. And so if you want to check that out, it's studentspeakout.ca. We'd love to have more signatures on that petition. We're going to be meeting with the Liberal caucus in February, and it would be great to have a lot of kind of voices in support of our asks that we're going to be taking to government. So that's basically my bit. I'm going to pass this over to Amy.
Thank Thank you, Jonathan. Is this working? So my name's Amy. I am the chair of Students Nova Scotia. I'm going to kind of expand on what Jonathan's been talking about and give a little bit of a perspective from a student's point of view. So I guess I'll start off with saying, being a part of this organization, I'm from St. FX on the executive there, and I've really found the value this whole year working with students and us. And I think that there are a lot of things that can come from having collaborative groups like this, and I think that Students Nova Scotia really well kind of represents that. So the fact that we're collaborative and the fact that we're member-driven is really important, and you can see in the things that we've achieved, I guess, over the past couple years that that is super important and is really fundamental to who we are. So Students Nova Scotia, as it exists today, as Jonathan mentioned, has been around for approximately 1.5 years. So from the start, as you know, the DSU has been an integral player in this organization, and in fact, they contributed funding from the DSU budget to bring this organization to its current form. And as Jonathan said, last year we rebuilt our entire internal governance system, and DSU and the other members of the board have been really integral in that process, and it has essentially been driven by the members. And further to that, I guess we have taken many actions that we believe are going to really bring us forward and really allow us to live out those values that we mentioned on the presentation. So one of those, for example, is the student assembly model. As Jonathan said, was very much inspired by members of the board from Dalhousie. And we really think that things like that are going to be able to really give us an edge in terms of student engagement and presence in the province. So we have made significant leaps in pushing for changes to PSE that benefit those students that need it most. So this is what we think is really important, giving assistance to those students who are most in need. So we've won results that benefit all students, but in this presentation, particular to Dal, because you are some of the students who pay the most tuition, among the highest tuition, we have pushed for investments of approximately $25 million in 4 years. To convert loans to grants, further increasing the maximum student financial assistance and eliminating interest on student loans. So we think this is super important. Other achievements, I guess. We've won the second largest new social policy investment in the 2013 budget in a context where the province was trying to close a budget gap of $350 million. As Jonathan kind of alluded to in his presentation, I think one of the best things about this organization, and one of the things that I've really appreciated in my time as an executive, is that it really is a resource for students' unions to collaborate and to make change. I guess I'll give a little bit of an anecdotal story. With work that I'm doing in my position on campus with sexual assault prevention and awareness, through this organization, we were able to make links with the province and with Students Nova Scotia to bring funding to a program that we've been pushing for in Antigonish that's been seen as really innovative, the bystander intervention program. So in having the collaboration with Students Nova Scotia, and this is something that you can see on all the other campuses that are involved on the board, is really important because it really allows for us to make links and to be a part of those conversations that are really important. And time again, we've been told that Students Nova Scotia has been a part of these conversations, and we've had access to information that is really really beneficial to the reports that we write, and we have meetings with both bureaucrats and elected positions around these issues, and I think I can't stress enough how imperative that is. Okay. So as I said before, I think you could probably all echo my sentiment that collaboration is very important in terms of pushing for some of the changes that we need to see for student assistance and post-secondary education in the province. As you know, the climate in the province, we have a declining population of youth, we have increasing aging population, and an economy that really is kind of struggling at the moment. So I think that this is imperative, especially during these times, to have a strong student voice, and I think we find that through Students Nova Scotia. The one thing that I'll kind of end with, tonight coming into this presentation, we hadn't been formally informed that that this was a presentation considering whether or not we would be continuing membership with Students Nova Scotia. And I think I just want to touch on the fact that we really, along the process, have been working really collaboratively, like I've mentioned, and DSU has been really integral to our operations as an organization. And I think we've seen support from DSU, like I said, with the student assemblies model, with 79% of our motions that we've passed, or sorry, DSU has been involved in 79% of the motions that we passed and voted for them, I guess. Sorry, that was kind of convoluted there. And I think what we have seen is really, really fundamental participation from the DSU, and we really want to see this continue. And we hope that you can kind of take tonight to think of some critical questions and to really think about the things that the DSU has been able to achieve through Students Nova Scotia and what we've been able to achieve as a collective. And I would just urge you to take the chance to really ask those questions and to give us more time, I guess, than just a presentation to be able to express those to you, because we really do feel that we are stronger as a collective. And going forward, we appreciate the DSU's involvement and every other member's involvement and think that's really integral. I don't know if you wanted to add anything, Kyle or Jonathan?
I guess all I would add is that there is, to my understanding now, an advocacy review at the Dalhousie Student Union that relates in some ways to Students NS's status with the DSU. I think it's important to say that at no point was Students NS informed of the advocacy review. At no point was Students NS contacted with reference to the advocacy review by anybody conducting the advocacy review to ask any questions about the organization. Many of the documents in the advocacy review, as far as I've seen, because I've never seen the advocacy review documents, but in terms of the posters, don't actually refer to Students NS even by the proper branding of the organization. And invited to this presentation, I've understood now that it's in the context of an advocacy review. But initially, we were invited on a basis that we were going to talk about a housing report that we completed recently, or a general introduction to the organization. At no point were we informed that the DSU status within Students NS was at all in question. And so I think, I hope that that is under consideration, and I hope that if the DSU's membership with Students NS, which is a relationship that in terms of money alone, implies $100,000 in students' money that was approved to the organization less than 2 years ago, those conversations will take place over more than a half an hour presentation at this time. I hope that decision will be made based on more information than we can provide within a half an hour and more conversation than we can have in just over a half an hour. And that we, in the future, won't be brought into meetings in reference to this without having been informed in advance that that is the subject of conversation. So I guess that would be the last thing that I would add. So we're free. We're happy to take any questions. I guess the very last thing we could say is just to acknowledge some of the people that are in the room. Gorba Bhandari has come down. He's the president at St. Mary's University Students Association. Matt Rios is here from Acadia Students Union president as well, and the president for the past 2 years. A member of the board of directors for 2 years at Students Nova Scotia. We've been happy to have Kyle Power here, who's the former chair, served on the board of Students Nova Scotia for 3 years, was chair for 2 years. We're obviously taking this very seriously, and we did have to kind of rush people at the very last minute to be here, recognizing the importance of this meeting, and I hope that that's also acknowledged. And frankly, I'm personally quite touched that these folks made it down here to attend. So those would be the last things that I want to add.
You'll get to questions very soon. My name is Kyle Power. I've been working with Students Nova Scotia since 2010. Back then it was called the Alliance of Nova Scotia Student Associations, and working with Dalhousie all the way back to Shannon Zimmerman, if anyone in the room knows who that is. And I think that, coming from, ANSA's perspective and Students Nova Scotia's perspective and working with the DSU for the last 3 years, it's far more than just your contribution is far more than just the money you put into the organization. Some of my most integral partners we are working with, the results that we've seen there have been from the DSU, and your influence and the work you put in, I think, is more valuable than any sort of anything that you put a dollar amount on. And I think that keeping the student movement kind of united in this province, I think, is very important. So I'd be happy to take any questions.
I'm on the board of the South House here. So obviously one of our, part of our focus is on rape culture and sexual assault prevention. So I know that some of the work your organization has done has been criticized in the past by feminists. And I actually saw this week that there was a feminist who was quoted in an article criticizing misogyny in your organization and a boys club culture, and considering that the chair had to resign this year because of chanting about rape. I don't know. I think it could be argued that criticism might be warranted. And I understand that she was actually served a cease and desist, or that she was threatened legal action. So I'm wondering how we can expect that you're going to seriously challenge sexism when criticism is met with legal threats.
Thank you for the question. I guess the first thing that I'd like to speak to is the question of Jared Perry as the former chair of Students NS. Jared Perry's nomination as chair was supported by the Dalhousie Student Union. His nomination was seconded by the Dalhousie Student Union's vice president academic. I would not suggest in any way that that indicates that your student union or your VP are misogynists. And I think that the same inference towards Students Nova Scotia is equally invalid. With respect to whether or not, you know, an individual was sent a letter to cease and desist, I think the fact that there was grounds for that letter is an indication of probably the quality of the discussion that was taking place. Now, with respect to kind of our activities around sexual assault prevention, Amy Brierley can speak to that very well, because she's been involved in a lot of those initiatives. So I'll pass the mic on that to Amy Brierley.
So can I just clarify, the second part of your question was how we hope to make a significant impact in rape culture on campus or campuses? Okay. I was on the steering committee for the sexual assault prevention project that was just released. And I will let you know that there was an immense amount of conversation around the report and how we were going to release it in a way that was mindful of the systemic issues that are on our campuses. This is something that we struggle with on all of our campuses, and I think that we know as individuals of any gender that sexual violence is something that's very real on our campuses. And I think stepping forward, this was a member-driven project, and this was something that we wanted to pursue as a board. We saw it as something important, and we were supported by the province to do so. So I think in moving forward with that and having the people on the steering committee that we had, we hope that we can release something that'll give a resource to students who are working to change culture on campus, to create safer campuses. In terms of feminist reporters commenting on the report, I think that we did do our due diligence to have those conversations, and I know that I was very critical throughout the whole process of what was being put into the report. We did, like Jonathan mentioned, approach Venus Envy to get that critical approach, and I think that through those conversations, we were able to really kind of conceptualize what this report was and how this was going to affect our campuses moving forward. So I think in terms of moving forward with making change on campus, there have been issues, and we've seen that, and I think it's something to be said that we're recognizing that and moving forward in a positive way.
Thank you, guys, and thank you for preparing such an excellent presentation on such short notice. It was really good to hear a lot of the facts. I was just thinking maybe, John, I don't know if you had a chance to mention this, but maybe you could speak just very briefly to when you joined the organization and with the changes you've witnessed, maybe the increased capacity that the organization has seen, and then maybe the kind of vision that you have for how this can continue. I mean, obviously, you're still an extremely young organization, but with the capacity you have, you've built a lot of momentum. So if you could maybe just speak to the ideas that you have for how this could continue in the future and what the changes you've seen since the organizational changes have happened.
Yeah, I mean, the organization, I've been on the job for 22 months. Now, I mean, Kyle could speak to the organizational changes the best because he was on for quite a while, but it was a one-person show in terms of the staff and then a co-op student or an intern. I mean, to have a $350,000 organization in a province the size of Nova Scotia is, I don't think, has ever happened in Canada. Or I mean, maybe I'm wrong. I could be totally wrong. But it certainly hasn't happened before in Nova Scotia to have the kind of reach that we have, to be in the media on average twice a week, systematically. To be, you know, we are getting involved in housing discussions kind of systematically in Halifax. Roundtables hosted by the mayor of Halifax have been involving students in Nova Scotia because of our work on housing. We're systematically involved in employment initiatives, so the Workforce of the Future program in Nova Scotia that's kind of developing strategies for building our workforce moving forward and ensuring that young people are getting opportunities to stay here and succeed here, or to come here and succeed here, as opposed to staying. I think that's a really important kind of change in thinking from youth retention to youth attraction. I know that there's going to be, or I've heard that there will be significant elements from Students Nova Scotia's work in the soon-to-be-released Ivany Commission on the Development of the Rural Economy in Nova Scotia. I mean, I think the changes have been immense. The capacity of the organization has increased so significantly beyond kind of what I think we would have envisioned. And that's a big part of why I got involved in student politics first, right, was that I never was involved as a student in student politics. I didn't think it was interesting. It was after when I was graduating that I realized some of the work that could be done and the significance of the issues that we work on. And so $25 million in 4 years to the students with the greatest financial need is an immensely meaningful thing. And the other incredible thing has been what you can do as a 24 or 25 year old, or a group of 24 to 20 year olds at a board of directors instructing people that are working for them that are professionals, is remarkable. Like what we have been able to achieve and what we're kind of building the capacity to achieve moving forward. So we're 18 months into a building process. I'm always kind of thinking how fascinating it'll be in a year and a half when this thing is, you know, really kind of built and we have the baseline and policy and we have, you know, we shift resources into kind of away from perhaps building that policy groundwork and more into implementation. And that I think is going to be, you know, really fascinating.
And just to add to that, I think it is really important that we consider that this is pretty early days. Like a year and a half is quite a short time, and I think the work that we've done so far is really substantial. And I think, like you said, Jonathan, moving forward, the opportunities to kind of expand beyond what we're already doing are quite large. And I think that I think we can be an even greater force as we move forward. So
the majority of time that I spent with Students Nova Scotia, it was called ANSA, and we had one staff member. And I think the impetus to expand kind of came out of, we were having a lot of conversations about, you know, rape culture and about employment and about housing. And we were realizing that, you know, a lot more affects students' lives than just student assistance. But we didn't have the capacity to make a lot of headway on these issues because we were so limited. We were, you know, we were just a board that we had a lot of responsibilities back on our campus. Our executive director, you know, was one human being that worked a 40-hour week, and, you know, that's kind of all he could do. And so we were having all these conversations, and it was really depressing to, you know, put them in the shelf and said in the maybe shelf, maybe someday shelf. And, you know, we said, why don't we start working on these projects, and how do we start working on these projects? And that's kind of where the kind of impetus to expand has led. You know, and I'm really heartened to see kind of all the work that we're now getting respected for and that we're doing on behalf of students. You know, I think it's good work, and I think it's what we wanted to do, you know, 3 years ago.
So my question, I don't really know how to phrase this. I'm going to try because it's kind of long-winded. But oftentimes, it's kind of a governance kind of question. And oftentimes, I come from a policy background, MPA student. Oftentimes, organizations are undermined, I think, when they serve a critical policy capacity, when they have a policy capacity in order to actually influence decision-making. and you talked about your role and actually the research reports you do, the evidence-based policy work that you do, and how it's actually being used by deputy ministers in the province, Sandra McKenzie, as you mentioned, in labor advanced education. So I was wondering if you could really comment on, you know, if we were to, if Students Nova Scotia were to be reduced in its capacity, what challenges do you think that this would pose on a fundamental governance level for organizations, for student lobbying in the province, and, you know, not having that politically neutral arm's length policy evidence capacity, right? You know, it not being tied to partisan interests, right? You know, if the DSU changes next year, or if, you know, student organizations change the following year, it might not be the same issues. But yet, if you're a politically neutral capacity, the same issues will be important, right? That's kind of long-winded. But, you know, if you could just comment as to the importance of that, or...
With a single staff member, hey, something's on the schedule. We can't write the reports that we do now. I mean, and certainly maintain all the other activities. You're left in this kind of dichotomous choice. Are you an engagement organization or a research organization? And we've been trying to say that we can do all of these things, and we probably have to make some tough choices around that, and we probably have to pull back on both sides, on both kind of, you know, activities. That's really critical. And I guess, you know, one big part of advocacy that I think organizations like ours fulfill that's really critical is relationships. And it's not the traditional lobbying thing, I don't think, of like relationships with politicians per se. What the people that we meet with systematically all the time are bureaucrats. And that's where we have very critical relationships, and that they know who to talk to. And we can participate in different working groups. So we're on a working group right now with a number of bureaucrats from different departments that are trying to sort out how the Student Assistance Program and the Employment Nova Scotia Program and income assistance programs work together in supporting people going to post-secondary. And that's because we've been working closely with people from all of those departments and all of those programs, sustained over a long period of time, and they have confidence that we're going to contribute in a room if we're in a room. There's a number of responses to that. I think, you know, one of my colleagues on staff sent an email about how he thought the most important thing that we did was building relationships with government, was creating the opportunity to have relationships between students and government, and having a student employees who are there for a bit longer that allow to facilitate and build those relationships and sustain them over time. And that, I think, responds to some of your question in terms of that's where a lot of the policy impact comes from. But without the resources, we have to, you know, all of it is downgraded. And I guess the last thing to say is that, you know, it's already difficult in this province with a Canadian Federation of Students and a Students Nova Scotia in a province of less than a million people. Like, that's already a challenge to have two parties. It's a challenge that's been there for a long time. To talk about having more parties is to, you know, divide the voice further. And we have, I don't know, I wouldn't provide an assessment, but I haven't heard government speak positively of meeting with individual student unions directly. They want to deal with voices that speak for united student groups, as opposed to engaging, say, with 11 student unions on an individual basis. That's not, that is not viewed as a constructive way, certainly by the government bureaucrats that we work with to work together. But I hope that kind of answers different thoughts.
Oh, I don't know. I just wanted to bring it over there. Go ahead.
Hi, my name is Elise, and I work for the Equity and Accessibility Office here at Dal. And I had a question about international students. You mentioned that you support a tuition freeze for 95% of international students, which still means that international students are paying drastically more than domestic students for the same education, and international students who are often racialized students. Isn't that an inherently inequitable position? Because the provincial government and the federal government aren't lobbying for international students, shouldn't be your position to lobby for these students?
That's a good question. First of all, we are advocating for international students. The work that we did on international students is the most concentrated piece of work on behalf of international students that's ever been done in Nova Scotia. We were speaking with students systematically over an extended period of time. The issue of international differential fees is complicated. It's not the best way to put it, but basically there's the issue of citizenship, and where we're constantly thinking of where do we need to put the money, what is government's responsibility, and where are we going to get the most value in terms of making a difference in people's lives. At this time, certainly, we were talking in the context last year, $350 million budget gap that the government has identified as a priority to close that gap. One of the ideas is to wipe out international differential fees. That's about a $40 million expenditure. It's basically there is no political will to implement that policy. On the other hand, is that a policy that representing 40,000 students who, many of whom are not international, is the most responsible? International differential fees are traditionally legitimated on the basis that the students that are paying them are not citizens of Canada. They haven't been contributing to the tax base in Canada. Their families are not paying taxes into Canada, which ultimately pay for the public's contribution. So the differential is intended to cover the public's contribution for the student. So basically, an international student is a non-citizen, is paying the public's contribution. What we have recommended is that be regulated so that that's true, so that international students aren't being exploited and required to contribute more to the university than a domestic student. We've also been kind of the first to look at whether or not there are additional costs for educating an international student, and we've argued that there probably are additional costs to cover to educating an international student, but those should be covered by the public because there are benefits to having international students in our province in our classrooms, and there's a lot of potential for keeping them here after they graduate. So in that context, recognizing those dynamics of kind of non-citizenship, of a very constrained financial environment where universities are in kind of a very serious financial position in terms of having to change their business model, we came up with a position to reduce international differential fees by 5%, but not do it across the board. We're not reducing fees for higher income students. We're not reducing fees for students that are on full scholarships from their governments, which is the case of a substantial, though small, around 10 to 15%, I think, of this international student population. Let's give that differential reduction to the students with need. So you would wipe out their differential fees. And that's our systematic approach, to give money to the people that need it the most, as opposed to spreading it more thinly. And that was, under the circumstances, the best approach that was taken, and that was voted in by our board of directors last May.
I don't agree with the argument that because international students are a smaller population, that it's not feasible for your organization. But as you mentioned, one of your priorities for married students, which I would argue is a smaller population. You mentioned that married students are significant, but I would just argue that international students are a more vulnerable population.
A lot of your married students, your students with families, are
very often from families that don't traditionally access post-secondary, who might have children when they're younger and then try to go to school with children, who often might come from racialized communities, and face a lot of particular challenges. So whether, you know, it's not really a question of the numbers of international students. I think it was more a question of who is government responsible for. And we are responsible for ensuring fairness, absolutely. But are we responsible for going beyond fairness to ask government to invest money there that, say, it could put to families, students with families, who are coming from communities that have a very, very tough time educating international students, accessing post-secondary. And I would add on international students, one of the critical elements is, you know, say we're talking Chinese students coming to Canada or to Nova Scotia. You know, on the one hand, to what degree is it Nova Scotia's responsibility to ensure that Chinese students can access post-secondary? It's really important because we want to have a diverse classroom, but ultimately the Chinese government is responsible for ensuring that its students can access post-secondary. Now, beyond that point, I think if you go further to say that Canada has a responsibility to ensure that Chinese students can access post-secondary, is the most effective means of doing that making it cheap for them to go to school in Canada? Or is it, say, upping your financial aid to China so that China can offer more university spaces in China to Chinese students? It breaks down pretty quickly, I think, when you have to think about how you're spending money and when you have to think about the broad population. Generally, the international student population tends to be higher income from their community of origin. I'm an international development grad. I would support greater aid to developing countries to expand, say, post-secondary participation, absolutely. But I think when you're dealing with the question of access, it takes a little more critical reflection in terms of what is an effective access strategy. Like, what are the principles that you're thinking it through, and where do they extend to? And those are the reasons I think that our board of directors took the stance that it took, that we do want to make sure international students that come to Nova Scotia that they're getting a fair deal, and that we're making it affordable to come here. But we're going to target it. We're going to target it to people that need the help the most. I think I'm going to pass it just so that we get multiple.
Okay, just let me clarify.
I'm not arguing about the Canadian government. I'm arguing that SNS has the responsibility to its members.
We asked
for 5% question. Grazie. Can we go back a couple slides? There was the one on the projected student populations for 2035, was it?
Yeah.
There. I'm just kind of wondering, so that projection for 2035, how does that work exactly with what you just said about the international student bodies, especially if we're not trying to incentivize them to come here more? Because, like, the well will dry up. They'll go to wherever's the cheapest, yeah? So.
That's a good question. This is fun. The challenge is going to be to attract international students, absolutely. Right now, you know, in terms of how we're positioned, Nova Scotia has the third or fourth lowest differential tuition in the country. We're well under the national average. And if you had a freeze, we would be moving down that list as opposed to up that list, so pursuing our recommendations. And again, you would be wiping out the differential for 5% of the student population. So the proposal that we've made would make Nova Scotia more competitive nationally as opposed to less, and it also supports us being more competitive by providing better services, by providing better value. And that's a huge part of the challenge.
I'll just quickly add, in our pre-budget submission for this coming year, we have included MSI coverage as one of our asks. So when international students come to Nova Scotia, they have automatic MSI coverage. So I guess advocating for changes like that can also be extremely beneficial.
And that'll be the second year in a row.
I actually recall the focus groups that we did with international students in particular before the release of that paper and those recommendations. And what we heard from the international students is not necessarily what we expected. What we expected to hear was a lot on the differential. But what the international students particularly, we had quite a large group at SMU, and they talked quite a bit, not necessarily about the differential, certainly came up, but they talked a lot about employability, a lot about respect in the community, a lot about MSI coverage and things like that. So that's why we've included a diversity of asks.
Can we do one more question? I've seen Rams has had his hand up.
Maybe we can do the pre-budget group. I'm going to put the mic here and everyone can jump for it.
Great, thanks for coming. During this slide, we were talking about how domestic students were low and middle income students, and then we talked about how domestic student enrollment is on decline. So that makes it clear that domestic students already can't afford post-secondary education. And I think students at Dalhousie have recognized that and have taken it upon themselves to collaborate with other universities to start advocating and lobbying government to do their own research. And I'm just curious about why we should invest $100,000 a year to be advocating for a tuition freeze for this organization when we're already advocating for lowering tuition on our own.
So I guess a couple comments on that. One is that what we were saying was that about 25% of the student population is lower income, right? That means that our priority with student assistance delivers support to that 25% lower middle income students the most, by far. Whereas the policy that you're proposing delivers 75% of the value to the other students. And so that's the direction that our board of directors has instructed us to go, is to target funding based on need. Beyond that, I think the trends in terms of enrollment are not per se related to cost. Improving access, I think, is always critical and would help turn around these trends. But fundamental realities are demographics. Our youth population here is declining by 30% over 25 years. So that's birth rate. Now, I think, oftentimes people will think that the default position, if you're a progressive, or not necessarily the default position, but progressive position, is a tuition reduction position. And I come from, I'll be totally upfront, I come from the left. I firmly will believe, and this is my personal belief, that the progressive position, by far, in post-secondary education, is to support targeted assistance for people that are lower income. So the policies that we've recommended for student assistance changes would, in the case of the people with the greatest financial need, it would deliver them free tuition because they would get full grant component on their student assistance amounts from Nova Scotia government. And the reality in the financial environment that Nova Scotia's in, we just voted out the left-wing government in Nova Scotia, quote unquote, that we had. It's a constrained financial environment. We will access certain amounts of money, and we're trying to access the most that we can, and we've been very, very successful under the circumstances. But setting priorities, our priority is for low-income students. And our priority, as I've understood it from our board ever since I've been in this organization, and from my understanding of this board direction, including with the Dalhousie Student Union for quite some time, has always been that our focus is on people with that come from low-income backgrounds and meeting people's financial needs first and foremost. And I think oftentimes that reflection, I think a lot of people would come to the same conclusion in terms of where you have to make choices.
I just had a question about, I know last September that Students NS was starting a project on students for accessibility and permanent disabilities. I was just wondering if there's been any developments in that project, or if you finally figured out what the guidelines were or what the proposal actually looked like. It's fairly vague back in September.
Thanks for the question. So that's a report that's been ongoing. It's hit delays related to, I think for very, very legitimate reasons internally that I don't really want to talk about in this context. But the project is moving and should be prepared in the next little while. It's a project on accommodations for students with disabilities, and it's being led by Katie Bauer, who I don't know if anybody's familiar with, but is on staff with Students NS and a brilliant speaker and somebody who's kind of gone through the accommodation process herself and learned quite a lot from it. So that project is moving forward, and we're hoping to have a result out of that fairly soon.
I guess whatever you guys are comfortable with. We have email addresses. You can contact myself, or and I can leave. Well, Sagar, I'll leave my information with you, and or.
Our website is www.studentsns.ca. You can see on the website we keep a record of results that's public on that website. We also keep a record of setbacks. So when we fail to get results and things get worse, it's also recorded. Our minutes are available freely on the website. Our governance policies are available freely on the website. And all of our media hits, when they come up, are posted to the website as well. So in our reports, whatever. Studentsns.ca.
And on that website as well, there's a contact information for all the board members. So I guess that's probably the easiest way to access that.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Should be. We just have a few technical problems. So
okay, did you need anything?
We're just grabbing another laptop. This one's a video report. Team has some difficulty.
Okay, cool. There's 10 bits.
Are you a
It all works.
See, the solution had to show up before it felt like it was going to participate. Especially during blizzards. Thank you very much for inviting us to come speak here today. Thank you for taking the time out of your evening. I know there's some changes in schedule, so we really do appreciate you being here tonight to listen to a little bit about what we have to say about federal advocacy and the Canadian Alliance of Student Associations. As you have just found out, my name is John Champagne Showers, as it's been so dubbed. I'm the National Director of the Canadian Alliance of Student Associations. I hail from the great GTA suburb of Markham, just outside Toronto. Oshawa in the crowd. I did my undergrad at Wilfrid Laurier University. Worked for a couple years, and then a master's at Queen's. At which point, I worked for about a year with the Ontario government in the Ministry of Community Social Services and Ministry of Economic Development. And then about 7 months ago, I was lucky enough to get this job here, and I've been in Ottawa ever since.
I think I'll drop the mic because...
Oh, sorry.
I understand that the mic is an important part of this process. As Sagar said, I'm Michael, not going to corporately brand myself McDonald. A little about myself in the past. I did my undergraduate at a small undergraduate school in the Eastern Townships called Bishop's University. I completed a master's degree in international environmental law from Macquarie University. Through that time professionally, I've worked for the Green Party of Canada for about 2 years. That included working on both their 2008 and 2011 campaigns as one of the managers of their information center, so responding to questions and engaging with stakeholders. I came to CASA now. I guess old hack. I've been here for 2 years as of probably 15 days ago. So this is my second year here, and I'm definitely, you know, the old one. We're going to have a presentation that will go over a few things. I'm going to hand it off to John.
So our agenda for the evening is fairly straightforward as possible. What is CASA, Canadian Alliance of Student Associations? Why focus federally? How does the federal government, what happens in Ottawa, directly impact students here at Dalhousie? A little bit about the federal political landscape and what it is actually like to be in Ottawa and having to advocate on behalf of students. How CASA as an organization, what we do, what we work, how we work to achieve results for students. A little bit of the things that students have fought for and that has been resulted in legislative policy and budget changes with government. And then look at the current ahead, which is supposed to be current year, and some of the priorities that were selected by the membership on what CASA will be advocating for. So a little bit about CASA as an organization. Again, we are a collective of student unions, student associations. We represent 24 members from across Canada, representing over 300,000 students. We have an organization, a fairly small organization, 5 full-time staff. So that's myself, Michael, manager of stakeholder relations. We have 2 policy and research officers, and then a government relations officer as well. Our budget ranges between $500,000 and $550,000, depending on the year. CASA's membership does fluctuate at times. And then again, one of the key notions of our organization is member-driven, democratic. We're a very responsive, member-driven organization.
So an important question I think anybody would ask, being familiar in the Canadian context, is why do I care what the federal government thinks about post-secondary education? There is, constitutionally, a mandate to the provinces to be responsible for pretty much all things PSE. That said, the federal government loves to involve itself in other things, and it's one of the reasons that CASA was originally founded in 1995 by students, including Dalhousie Students Union, was the importance to involve itself in some of the very particular federal government charges itself with it. This includes a variety of different elements, and to be honest, this involves a lot of money in the Canadian context. The federal government is the largest body that collects taxes, and it has an involvement in many different things in the goals of keeping Canada's society vibrant and competitive. So directly for students and the direct transfers, is that Canada is very much invested, the federal government's invested, in providing Canadian student loans. Now many of you will ask, especially if you probably applied for a student loan in the past, you don't apply with Canadian student loans program in most cases. This is the system that sits behind the provincial systems in most instances. This is about 60% of the funding that goes into the Nova Scotia Student Assistance Program. This sits behind that system and has a variety of requirements that the federal government sets. And these requirements are a variety of regulations. And these are some often points where CASA advocates, whether it be to federal institutions or elected officials. It's also involved in some of the largest direct transfers to the provinces. And many of these can be earmarked. The federal government can say this money is designed for this task. And lobbying on that and engaging on that is something that students have done in the past, and something you can continue to do. Also, programs such as youth employment all fall into that ESDC, and I do take this one moment to stop you guys. I talk in acronyms far too often. Acronyms are kind of an Ottawa thing, and there's lots and lots of acronyms. So if I talk in acronyms, please wave your hand and be like, Michael, you're making no sense. So, what else is there? Because the federal government involves itself in a myriad of different places that don't concentrate themselves in a single department. With no Department of Education, you have a scattered and very, unfortunately, bureaucratic system when trying to engage with the federal government to see real policy change for students. So that might mean you're going to go talk to the Department of Foreign Affairs and Trade if it's an international student issue. If it's how we give visas to students, it's how we should ensure that students are able to access the country more often. So that might be multiple re-entry visas, where some countries right now are limited to single entry visas, which makes it very difficult to ever return home. It could be the Department of Finance, if anything on tax policy, and they're also the ones who dole out the money to each department. So being able to be actively engaged there is important as well. You have places where the federal government is the dominant provider of funds, which includes all funding for First Nations education in this country. The federal government is solely responsible for this, and has an independent system which provides funds directly there. We'll talk about it a bit more. You also have other systems that maybe involve how to improve policy and how to improve the way that we understand our education and understand students' education. That's lobbying and engaging with potentially Statistics Canada and talking about them and what kind of surveys they provide. And a variety of other things. This includes consultations the CASA very often in with groups such as Elections Canada, how to ensure that students have an equal opportunity to vote, and if not a better chance, because of their very unique environment and a lot of the transient nature that students live in. And it also means a lot of money that goes into research. The federal government is the largest purveyor of research funding in the country, bar none. And the tri-councils, which are in all acronym soup, NSERC, SHRC, and CIHR, which each, so be SHRC would be the Social Sciences and Research and Humanities Research Council, which provides money to most arts programs, the Natural Science and Engineering Research Council, rather self-explanatory, and CIHR, which is responsible for health funding in the country. These are huge sections of money that go to both many grad students and they go to a variety of undergrad students as well. And engaging directly on those policy areas of how this money is distributed to students is incredibly important. It's been a lot of CASA's advocacy over the years. There's a few other things as well that engage in many places that each campus will know. Something like deferred maintenance and the ability to maintain buildings is constantly a question that provinces have to deal with and institutions. And the federal government, when it opens up its purses on us, has some of the most money available to engage on this question. And that was last done in 2009, where the federal government was able to distribute about $2 billion like that. And these are the places where it can engage.
So looking at the federal landscape in terms of post-secondary education and CASA's partners, as an organization, like I mentioned, we're not a very big organization. And the way we can try and be as effective as we can with our limited resources is by engaging various partners in Ottawa, or perhaps they might be located outside of Ottawa as well. So just to give you some of the idea of the organizations we work with, CARL, which is the Canadian Association of Research Libraries, again, pretty self-explanatory as to who they would represent. The ACCC represents community colleges. The AUCC will represent universities, of which Dalhousie will be a member of the AUCC. Polytechnics, Assembly of First Nations, an organization we work quite closely with on establishing policy for First Nations students in Canada. CBIE, someone we just reached out to not too long ago, Canadian Bureau for International Education, who again advocates on various policies related to international education, international students, both Canadian students going abroad and international students coming to Canada. CSC is kind of an interesting one as well, Campus Stores Canada. In fact, many bookstores on campuses are run as not-for-profits. The folks that represent bookstores are very much in line with students in terms of what can we do to work together to keep to bring the cost of textbooks, which has easily been the fastest growing area of post-secondary education. How can we bring the cost of textbooks down? And we've joined up with them pretty much going after some of the publishers on that one for about 2 years now. So again, when students and bookstores are able to help save costs and save money for students, this is how we can be effective. And then, of course, at the end there, we have the Council of Ministers of Education for Canada, which is a group that represents the ministers of education from the various provinces. So in Nova Scotia would be the minister for, I guess, the combined labor and advanced education here.
If I could add something quick on that slide. And it is an example of something that CASA really works hard to do, is also provide our student members with the ability to engage with these organizations as well when there's a priority that is particularly important. As a quick example, Sagar and I sat down with the AFN, with one of their main policy advisors, Luann Hill, and being able to provide better context for students to develop their policies, whether to be presented to CASA or whether to be advocated locally, and to be able to find that bridge, because these organizations are located in Ottawa very often, and engage in that kind of policy development themselves. You also see that currently, from a just general federal landscape, you're in a particular kind of environment that we think that CASA can provide particular value to all its members through its ability to influence what currently goes on. CASA is committed to being a nonpartisan organization. That is one of its founding principles, and our members have committed us to standing on that since our inception. That means if there is a liberal government, we will work with a liberal government. If there's a conservative government, we will work with a conservative government. If there's an NDP government or a green government in the future, we will commit to working with those to find ways to improve the lives of students in each of those environments. That does mean, to a certain degree, that we have to adapt within those. The current conservative government, which would naturally, in many instances, be inclined towards cutting back on certain kinds of social services. This is something conservative governments have committed. One thing that CASA is quite proud about, happy with, is that since the beginning of this conservative government, there's been no major funding cut to any kind of student assistance program. There's been no cut at all. In fact, the programs have all expanded, and they've been continued to be established as even a priority within this government setting. And it's something that can provide students with a variety of different programs, whether that be the 2009 implementation of the student grants program nationally, a variety of other times that CASA has been able to influence via conservative policy.
Just a couple other things which sort of make working with the conservative government a little bit unique. As federal priorities, take for example, we're working with the government right now who will balance the budget no matter what. So therefore, we have to adapt our policies where perhaps asking for lots of expensive things, while it's on our books and will continue to do so, make us realize a little bit that we have to also look at other policy changes, perhaps where this year, where the balance will be budget, come hell or high water, we need to adapt our advocacy strategies. Fragmentation of policy. Policy environment for post-secondary education in Ottawa is, again, really fragmented. Every single one of those boxes on that chart there with the Parliament Hill, essentially every single one has a different minister, a different political staff, a whole entire different bureaucracy. Makes navigating the waters there difficult frustrating at times, a lot of different sort of places you have to go and see and to be involved with. And then lastly, and I'll say this as a former public servant, relationships between bureaucracy and political lengths or political sides of an organization, in some cases are quite strong, in other cases are weak, where sort of what the public service might put forward as policy ideas or what it might think is the best route to go forward will not get adopted or listened to necessarily by various ministers or elected officials. This is, from a very Ottawa bureaucratic context, this is something that you clearly see right now, where we frequently work with folks at the Canada Student Loans Program in the different ministries, where we sit down with them and we discuss all these great policy ideas, things that might not even cost that much, and understand and hear that they can send ideas and things up to a minister's office, and it probably won't get the attention perhaps it deserves. So we continue to maintain those relationships with the public service, but then also we have to work with political staff and ministers and staff additionally.
So what does that involvement of the federal government look directly for Nova Scotia? Because that's really context that probably matters in this discussion. Currently, about $106 million are distributed to students in Nova Scotia to provide access to their education. Now, we all know that loans are not the way that we'd like most education to be provided. However, these loans are far better protected, as I'm going to explain in a few seconds, and are far lower interest rates than anything that any other system were providing that funds. Currently, they provide an access point, and they provide a better one than the alternatives on the private market. And they include some very important protections that I'm going to talk about. They also include, through the Canada Student Grants Program, about $22 million of direct grants that goes to students across Nova Scotia right now. That is the non-repayable aid that goes to those students in the most need, identified also by a variety of other components, which can include single parents who are returning to education and people who will be returning at another point. These loans are also protected by something the CASA is quite proud of for its advocacy efforts on, and that's the Repayment Assistance Plan. Starting in 1999 and eventually culminating in its adoption in 2009, CASA advocated for a Repayment Assistance Plan. What is this? And it's actually something I would really encourage all of you to be very familiar with. If you have a Canada student loan or a loan from Nova Scotia, because a good chunk of that will be Canada student loans, this money is protected in the sense that if you do not have income or if you're making less than $13,000 a year, you need not pay anything back on that loan while you're not making money. So this means that if you're making less than $13,000, the Canadian government steps in and pays for your interest, and it covers that. It also means that if a specific situation occurs where you might become incapable of ever repaying your loan, the Canadian government also has something that is called the Repayment Assistance Program, and it's called RAP-PD in the actual system, which will clear that loan for you. The federal government steps in and will cover that loan for students who cannot repay. This also kicks in if a student took 6 months away from education and for something like a mental health break. This is something we know is becoming an increasingly important thing for students to be able to access. And for a student who need not have completed their degree, but they have a Canadian student loan, this program ensures that after 6 months, if they are making less than $13,000, they don't have to repay any money, and they can take that time away. This is something we would, no matter what goes on, applies to all students who have these kind of loans. We encourage you to spread that information and to contact loan providers, because this is something that protects many students and not enough students are accessing at present.
There are a few other areas where the federal government is directly involved in Nova Scotia, but also right here on the Dalhousie campus. First off, you have the Canada Social Transfer. So that's one of the main transfers from the federal government to the province of Nova Scotia. A significant portion of that is earmarked towards post-secondary education. One thing our members have called us for is to sort of increase that transparency to know exactly how much money is supposed to go towards post-secondary education. Right now, it's just kind of a giant check that goes to the province, of which it gets distributed as they see fit. But research, and I don't think it's any surprise, especially as I was pulling these numbers, is that Dalhousie is really a research powerhouse in Canada, and is the beneficiary of significant amounts of federal government towards research. NSERC, Natural Sciences, this is just in the past two, the data is usually 1 to 2 years delayed, so this is about 2011 or 2012.
Dalhousie professors, students, undergraduate students were awarded $18.14 million. $408,000 went directly towards NSERC awards directly for undergraduate students. Social sciences, $13 million was awarded to students, professors at Dalhousie University. CIHR, Canadian Institutes of Health Research, and now obviously has a medical school here and an affiliation with the hospital. This is, again, they sort of present the data differently, but since 2008, Dalhousie was the recipient of almost $100 million, and many of those projects are ongoing for 4, 5, 6, 7 years. So research is really an integral component of federal government involvement in post-secondary education, and not only just, you know, enriches those who are able to receive that funding necessarily, but professors are able to then hire research assistants, teaching assistants. It provides a definite different learning environment, maybe a more richer learning environment for all students at Dalhousie. And then I didn't, lastly, 45 awards for Dalhousie University in terms of Canada Research Chairs, some of which may be professors yourself, and again, are nationally and internationally renowned professors, leaders in their field who are able to obtain either $500,000 or $1.4 million, depending on the tiers, again, directly to support their research, to support their students, their teaching, to be able to hire students, grad students on campuses. So that's the relationship between the federal government, Nova Scotia, Dalhousie, the students represented by DSU. So what we do as an organization is we take the members' priorities, what is happening on their campus, what matters to them. We combine it with various forms of advocacy. We combine it with all our research. We have two policy and research officers because, you know, evidence, research, data is, you know, what underpins good policy. We turn it into our advocacy, and ultimately, we like to say, it leads to results for students. So here are just some of the things we do as an organization. Media engagement, I think this is common even as a student union, you do this yourself. It is an effective way, can be an effective way, to put pressure onto policymakers, to decision makers, and to try and get resolutions when situations do arise. This one specifically is when the foreign service workers went on strike, and we were actively engaged, pushing hard to get the two sides to come to an agreement. Partnerships, Campus Store is one I mentioned. Mental Health Commission of Canada is when our members gave mental health as a priority for our organization, we immediately looked to see who we could reach out with. And the Mental Health Commission of Canada, which is the national body representing and advocating for mental health, is an organization we work closely with. For example, we worked on the World Suicide Prevention Day campaign with them and attending their rallies up on Parliament Hill on behalf of students. Consultations. CASA was one of only two student groups invited to speak before the House of Commons Standing Committee of Finance. The other ones being the Fédération étudiante Université du Québec, representing universities in Quebec.
You're getting better at saying that.
Yeah, keep practicing in the shower. Local outreach, when invited to do so, or if there's local issues, again, CASA will be there to support our members in that. Campaigns, right now, our national advocacy team is working, and we're working in the office to put together a campaign on debt and the problems that student debt has, not just for students who are students right now, but how it affects them into the future when they have to start working and earning a living, and how it can delay and set back. So wall of debt campaign, which I'm sure you'll hear about very shortly. And then lastly, meetings. And, you know, a big part of advocacy, a big part of being the student voice, is being able to get into the room, being able to get those meetings with MPs, with ministers. These are very, very busy people, and they have a very limited amount of time in their agenda. As an organization, we've met with nearly half of the current MPs in Parliament. We've met with representatives from the Prime Minister's office, as you see there, the leader of the opposition, Tom Mulcair, with folks from Justin Trudeau's office. And so we have been very successful. In our last advocacy, we had over 120 meetings. And when students are there in the room, sending the message of students in a united front with the common goals, common priorities, this is how we are effective in ensuring that what gets brought to policy, put in budgets, are able to make a difference and impact students. And then, of course, research is the sort of the foundation of all the policy we do, and making sure that it's evidence-based, it's backed up by science, and it makes sense.
So we want to look to a few of the successes that CASA has had over the years of existence. Specifically, we're going to focus on the last five, because that's probably the most relevant to the discussion and some of the mechanisms that are used to achieve that. CASA, from a direct asks that have been adopted by federal governments, CASA was involved recently in first moving the dollar limit that you're allowed to work and not have any loans taken away from you while you're in study from $50 to $100. The principle that our members said to us is that any student who is working should not be punished for doing so, and that is their choice. And that activity is something they should not have the Canadian government coming to them at the end of the year if they think they worked too much and demanding that they repay a loan during studies. This is an incredibly unfair system. CASA first got it moved from $50 to $100, but as the astute viewer will notice, $100 a week in student earnings is not particularly much. To be blunt, that's in many places working about 11 hours. And you don't get to choose how long you go to work very often. Unfortunately, many employers will be like, no, I'm giving you two shifts. Like, that's this job. And you shouldn't have to pay work those shifts at what will essentially be no money for those additional hours. So the Canadian, what is being advocated right now, and luckily has just been adopted as a recommendation by Canada's Finance Committee of the Parliament, is that we should examine removing this criteria entirely. But what also becomes important, and we understand that the costs of education are multifaceted. It is not just on the student financial assistance front, though that's incredibly important. It's looking at ways to change how we get textbooks, reducing that cost. Looking at ways that students have fair access to copyright. So CASA was one of the main organizations advocating for education being a component in fair dealing, which ensures that all students and professors are able to use copyright material in an education setting without being punished for that. There are some criteria that surround that, but if you put up a slide of, I don't know, The Simpsons in your presentation, you are not going to be like in violation of copyright, or you don't have to destroy that document afterwards, which were what some of the things that first came forward in the first iteration were. You've also seen a lot of other points of access that CASA has called straight on. Ending interest on part-time student loans, which was a system that charged interest while in study for students who were in study, which sounds silly and makes no sense. We also have been engaged very actively on the open access reforms engagement. And this is a really innovative place that could really start addressing a lot of the cost barriers in education. Who here is familiar with open access? Excellent. Like, this is a place where right now the federal government pays for a variety of different research projects. That research project is usually placed into journals. Those journals erect paywalls or demand subscription fees from your institution. And as I expect most of you are also familiar with, you probably run into paywalls when trying to access journals. This paywall for research that the Canadian people already paid for is a particularly silly thing. It is a punishment that Canadians shouldn't have to bear. So CASA last year began advocating on this, and we're really happy to hear that a draft policy has just been put forward at both SHRC and NSERC, and both organizations took consultation points on it, which just completed, and CASA provided more comments on that. And it's looking like a full policy will be available this year, and then from now on, things that are federally funded are going to also be mandatorily available in a free format in the future. This gets really interesting with some of the new other things that we're being advocated on as well. But that means like in total about $167 million has been able to be returned to students. And for an organization whose budget lives in the land of about $600,000 each year, that's a pretty good return rate. And that's been using our members' priorities to find those access points to provide this kind of benefit. What else have we seen? We've also made sure to involve ourselves in other points of access at the federal level. That can be consultations with NGOs, because we also understand that not all law or practice is developed at the federal government level. And there can be really important times that you should engage with the Mental Health Commission of Canada, which is an arm's length organization from the government, because if they're going to start a campaign, that's great. That's what we want too. And being able to engage in that in Ottawa is incredibly important. It also means being able to be involved almost always on consultation panels on a variety of really detailed stuff. I'm going to be presenting at a I'll be presenting at a policy session for what ends up being the Canada Student Loans Program at a consultation body they call NAGSPA, because we live just in acronyms, where we're going to be talking about a lot of specific policies to assist mature students. but we also participate on the Service Advisory Council there. So how does the paper that you're, or the digital form that you apply for your student loans look like? CASA is able to engage with that at the federal level in Ottawa because that's where those engagements happen. They request, like, their bodies show up there in Ottawa, they call up whoever's going to be there, and you get engaged in these processes. This also means the CASA has been involved with the consultations on the reformation of the if SHRC was a talent program, which was how they were going to distribute funds in specific formats. These kind of engagements are things that CASA does on a regular basis, and will bring in special members who are particularly interested in those topics to further assist. And one thing that I most recently actually, and Dal will be a big beneficiary of this, Dalhousie will have from Elections Canada a polling station which will allow students to vote from any riding. Elections Canada is now engaged to place 50 of these across the country on the largest campuses. These are bodies that are going to be that allow students to just bring a bill and are going to be able to vote either in their home riding or in their new riding, and will be considering the needs of resident students particularly, because we understand that that's a particular barrier that many campuses face, and this kind of benefit will further allow them and further allow student needs to better generate campaigns to ensure that all of their members can vote. One thing that CASA is very, very proud of, but we're not the only organization responsible for it, so we're not taking 100% of the credit, is that since we were created in 1995 by as students, there's been no cut at the federal level post-secondary education. There's been no cut during a Liberal government or no cut further on with a Conservative government. This has been an engagement that all of those bodies have been committed to providing assistance to post-secondary students across the country. And something we hope to continue on. We can't guarantee it is always going to happen, and undoubtedly someday there will be cuts, but it's something to continuously having students' voice at the table, no matter who's in charge, better ensures that this never occurs.
And if you follow federal politics at all, you would be quite aware that a lot of things have been cut federally. So what are the current member priorities? What did our members decide in June, that CASA will be advocating on this year? Student mental health. Again, for the first time this year, student mental health was adopted as a CASA advocacy priority. That's where we engaged the Mental Health Commission of Canada to talk with them, discuss how do we create a policy that is federally focused, that is able to assist with student mental health initiatives. We also called for $5 million of funding from the Mental Health Commission of Canada to conduct anti-stigma campaigns directly on campuses. Funding for Aboriginal education. Again, adequate funding for the post-secondary student support program. There is a significant backlog of students who are eligible right now to attend post-secondary education but are not able to receive that funding. Even worse is that program funding has been capped at 2% a year. With the cost of education rising at about 5 to 6% a year, that's essentially a 4 to 5% cut or 3 to 4% cut in the amount of funding available for Aboriginal students. The Canada Student Loans Program, this is a significant area of advocacy because, again, this is directly providing student loans and grants. So first, increasing the value of these student loans and student grants. They haven't been increased since 2004, and the cost of an education has increased significantly since 2004. And again, it's just not about increasing the loans, it's about increasing the grants and continuing to index them. We do not want students to take on any more debt, and grants themselves are the single best way the federal government can reduce the amount of debt students carry. Give them the money straight up front. Exempting all income while studying, that's what Michael was mentioning earlier. This is interesting. Elimination of parental contribution from needs assessment. The federal government right now does not treat students as independent learners. If your parents happen to work and make a decent income, you are now barred and punished because your parents earn a little bit more money. This fails to address several situations. One, there's an assumption in there that just because your parents might make some money is that they'll give you that money. This is clearly not true in many cases. There's also many other circumstances that aren't taken into effect. Perhaps you have 3 or 4 or 5 brothers or sisters who are all needing to go to post-secondary education. Perhaps you have a loan or a small business or something in which you have other obligations to meet. We are not able to support your child while in school. So eliminating that parental assessment is critical to ensuring that post-secondary education remains accessible and affordable. International students, again, allow part-time students to work off-campus. It's clear that international students pay significantly more than domestic students, yet if you're a part-time international student, you're very restricted in your employment opportunities. Also, make all international students who get their visas multiple entry visas. There are significant issues with students coming to study in this country who are not able to go home throughout their duration of their education. Not being able to go home for 4 years presents a variety of problems. Obviously, and if there is, for example, a family emergency or some reason they need to go home, then they need to reapply. There are additional fees, time delays, again, with being able to get a visa to come back and study in Canada. I'll turn the last two over to Michael because these are his favorites.
So, with so many people very familiar with open access, I'm going to see the same number of hands for how many of you are familiar with open educational resources? Hands up. Okay. This place is getting a little bit, it is a bit newer, and this is something that, depending on the province, has really just started entering into like the policy sphere recently. In fact, British Columbia has recently essentially made the 90 courses that are most attended, they've bought the rights to textbooks for those courses and opened those up, made them freely available to students. This is a place where we can address some of the places where costs are rising the fastest for students and provide a really innovative solution to addressing those costs. So OERs allow for those documents not only to be like duplicated, but then changed. So a professor can actively like splice two textbooks together. They can engage in a really innovative way of finding an open educational resource course plan to work with that. This is a place that really innovative stuff's gone on. You've already seen major cost reductions in textbooks for the cost that students have to pay for textbooks in states like Minnesota. And British Columbia just released a study that showed that students who could access these textbooks saw $150 off per semester in the amount of money they had to dedicate to textbooks. This is a place where you can come up with innovative policy, even when we're dealing with something like a conservative government who's very hesitant to spend money and still promote these opportunities. You also, something that I've been working on actually most recently with some of our graduate students, is been pushing for having a representative on the granting councils in Canada. This is a place that the councils themselves can kind of make this decision, but they've been really, really slow in doing it and have come up with really, a lot of really silly reasons that they haven't. So engaging with them, right now we're on a letter writing campaign directly to each one of the board members, encouraging all of our graduate student associations to send off letters to each member, stressing to them how it's important for students as a major recipient of research funding to have a representative on these councils. And that's something that was just being worked on in the last couple of weeks.
And lastly, there are a number of ways of which, as an organization located in Ottawa, we're able to support students at Dalhousie and the DSU. There's a variety of different ways. You know, being a little bit of a larger student union, DSU has, you have a lot of capacity within yourself. But you know, there are many other ways CASA can help play a role. For example, we worked with the University of Waterloo grad students when the federal government cut funding to the Experimental Lakes region. An area that those students impacted those students directly. This was areas where they were involved in the research and the data that was obtained from there, and obviously we're not very pleased about that funding decision. We work with them to put them in touch with various MPs, help them craft some letters, get some meetings, to be able to voice their concerns. And that is something we're able to do, whether it's with one of the partner stakeholders we work with, whether it's with the various MP or minister that might have a specific issue directly related to Dal campus, which might not necessarily be a policy position or stance of the organization, but is a resource we are there to be able to support with.
Just add a bit on that. And it's something that, here, we at CASA very much understand the current advocacy review, and we really are happy that members take the time to engage and assess our work. It's an important component, and it's something that we would just want to extend in this environment. We see, like, it's very clear that the DSU has done a fantastic job identifying both federal priorities to engage on and engage on really actively on the campus and create a culture that allows for more and more students to be involved in that process. Many of our campuses have very different needs. And one of the things we understand is we want to be able to complement and support your specific endeavors as well. That means that sometimes this priority might not be CASA's, the entire organization, but we still move to assist and support those organizations that adopt specific priorities. We provide research support to those organizations if they require an additional researcher. It depends on the context, and one thing that CASA has found is that respecting the autonomy of each individual student association and their own capabilities means we waste less student money and instead are able to focus more on achieving outcomes for students. Some student associations really don't want us to show up for a presentation. One of the reasons why CASA, as staff, we will only show up when asked. We don't go to an association, we don't engage, we don't produce materials unless asked to do so. We're happy to in those instances, but we feel that it's up to an association to best present how it wants CASA to be presented. Some associations, yes, they would like to keep that relatively executive-centered. We've also assisted on some very open spaces collaborative approaches to identifying student needs on campuses, including UPEI, where they engaged and wanted to have a very collaborative way that they could craft their own priorities for federal advocacy. We'll assist in whatever those mechanisms may be, and when we can, we'll also assist on what those like achievements are on campus, if you think we can provide you with that benefit.
Thank you very much, and I'll turn it over to you guys for questions.
First of all, thank you so much for staying here next night and being able to deliver this presentation to us. It was very informative. I just have a question about the priorities that CASA has going forward. And I was really surprised to not see tuition fees as one of the priorities of CASA. Does CASA support the reduction of tuition fees? And what is being done to reduce tuition fees while the quality of education is also faltering?
Excellent question. Specific at the federal level, tuition fees are not the mandate of the federal government. CASA has never supported and will never support the increasing of tuition fees. That's something our members have talked about actively. The federal government as a body is not responsible for that from a provincial level. That said, there are really important mechanisms that can influence that. The social transfer is the body that makes that pile of money that goes to the provinces is what many times dictates how much they transfer to universities as their component of funding student fees. So advocating on, and CASA has advocated very actively in the past, and probably with the next upcoming election, an important component will be advocating so the Canadian social transfer be increased. That will mean in some provinces, then engaging to ensure that that money goes, or being able to ensure that where that money is identified, making sure that the advocacy point that CASA has raised in the past, how can you know where that money goes, make the province accountable, and then transfers over to the province to make that decision depending on its context.
I hope I didn't miss this. I was just trying to find statistics on a few number of years ago, you guys had a quote for every dollar that was invested to CASA, what the return was on every dollar.
Excellent. I'm very happy people have been in some of our previous presentations. CASA has in the past used a statistic that had a return, a dollar return. Offhand, I don't want to make, I'm not 100% sure I can get the stat back. We made that assessment when moving into kind of new presentations. We want to talk about the the clear examples of achievement. I can get you that statistic again in a modern updated format if you'd like. I'll leave you my card at the end of this one.
So naturally, as an organization, I know you said I think it was, how many schools was it again that you represented? 24, right.
Member associations.
Right. Thank you, yeah. So obviously, membership like that is going to go up and down, and I think maybe some of the context that is most useful for students in a position that we are is, what would you say are some of the criticisms that are brought against the organization at times that you would like to address, so opportunities where certain schools have decided to leave, and maybe there are reasons for that, and why and what you have to offer to maybe as a retort to those principals.
Thank you. I guess here, CASA as an organization has definitely faced a variety of different assessments. And here, from our membership point, membership in CASA fluctuates quite regularly. It has been as high as 27, and it has been as low as 5. From our founding organizations, most of the organizations that were founding members are no longer part of CASA. Many new organizations have come in. We've had members who have come in and out and in and out and back in as many times go on. CASA understands that it is very important that student unions and their associations want to be a part of the organization and that it feels they can serve their interests. This is something that's critical, and I think that from a whole, it then kind of covers where they think they want to be when it comes to federal advocacy. Some organizations will say, this is not something we want to engage in right now, especially like in the Ottawa consultation, like this is something we just don't think is where we want to have our influence. From assessments of things that I've heard, I guess over the last year, when we've done some of these, and some of these are things that we take very much to heart, and we hope that we improve on as time goes on. An example would be our campus presence on many campuses is very little. Students will identify like,
who is CASA? What is CASA?
And ask that question really, really actively. One, we don't want to spend students' money advertising ourselves on your campus. That would be a terrible use of our funds. And that would be a terrible use of your funds. We allow each association to make its choice on how it wishes to represent the organization. This is really key because this is a limited pile of money, and it is something that we very much feel quite honored to be entrusted with, and making sure to maximize those dollars as much as possible. It's one of the reasons the CASA doesn't come and do presentations unless asked to do so, because if we were coming onto your campus and just saying, like, here's a presentation, we don't necessarily know if you want it. And many of our associations don't want that at a given time. So I think that that's probably one of the keys coming forward. Two, I think that you often hear the CASA is the political opportunity can be a confining thing. That an assessment that political opportunity, as seen as if you're working in with a conservative government, is something where CASA backs away from like larger asks. And what we say is that we ask associations in part to consider their context and to say that there's lots of really interesting opportunities to do those big asks at times. So an example would be, I would say, in 2011. The conservative government has just won a massive majority. They are going to be the government for 5 years. Identifying things that we can get into their policy book year one to start working with them is a way that we can ensure that we don't spend 5 years where students get nothing. And it's important that we identify those options. We're coming up to an election very soon. Something like removing parental income, this is starting to get into the land of like the more substantive ask. This would ensure that every student, if they so wanted, could have a student loan, pretty much. That would open up the criteria massively. And it would create a system that if they wanted that assessment, that would be their choice to do so. That would be a huge piece of progress. But it's something that obviously asking in 2011, when the government is committed to balancing the budget, might not have been something conservatives were going to want to hear and would shut you out. And I think that one of the things, I think the last thing, and I'll jump off from a third kind of component, is that CASA limits the member organization's ability to advocate further on things. And I'd almost make the counter to the critique that we actually empower you to do a lot more. When an organization wants to go and advocate beyond and above, has specific federal priorities that maybe the CASA membership didn't decide it was going to adopt, CASA provides a vehicle where things can be advocated on for 24 associations at all times. That's going to be pushed all the time. Your association will then be free to advocate for those things that might be here, that might shut you out of the doors with conservatives because if you're saying the government is terrible. There's really good reasons. Hey, I come from the Green Party. Like, there's definitely a lot of argumentation you could set on that. It gives the DSU the ability to advocate on that side while still talking to the federal government under the umbrella brand of CASA and being able to engage in the priorities done. That's short-term and long-term gain at the same time. And it allows for a differentiation of what you guys can accomplish. And we think that we provide a strong complement to that. We provide research staff who are able to assist on a local priority should it arise, but also research staff, they're able to supplement the policies that we were gonna go forward as 24 associations. And each of those has its unique weight. We agree that the associations should be as flexible, should have the ability to come up with their own really unique advocacy identities. But also, I think everyone acknowledges there is a strength in having a numbers-based association that provides specific asks to the federal government. I hope that was a comprehensive response.
Hey, thanks for coming. So we all know that Canada has one of the highest rates of tuition, as a result, student debt in the world, right? This isn't the norm. And so while I appreciate that part-time students don't pay loan interest while they're going to school and working, and then they're able to work as much as they want while they go to school and won't lose some of their loan because of it, and then when they become too overwhelmed because of having to work and go to school, there's a loan repayment program just for them based on whatever mental illness they acquire. I'm just curious why it's beneficial for us to invest $40,000 a year into an organization that's fighting for us to get better work options when we really want to be going to school.
That's an excellent, excellent question. And I think that the first component that members have presented to us is that student choice is an incredibly important component of identifying how they want to run their education and running how they receive, how they access their aid. So an example, a student working example, this is being able to ensure that if a student chooses to work or take a co-op, which is very often now the system that is part of an education, that they don't get punished for that. And this is being able to provide them with that choice to do it or not do it. Not be, if they're forced to do it, be punished for it. Now we understand that, yeah, a lot of the system is one where major improvements can still be made. And actively engaging on something like ensuring that the grants format is increased on an active basis. It's one of the reasons that it's fixed to inflation. So it would be continuously growing. One of the reasons CASA wants the system to get better over time. But there can be steps in the process of getting better. Making student loans more affordable and something that is less onerous on students can be one step. Yes, you're right. The next step we want is better grants. But being able to ensure that students today get something a little better is something that our members have told us is critical. And ensuring that they're able to see those kind of returns is something really beneficial to them all. Hope that.
Hey, just a simple question. You said you run campaigns. I was just wondering what active campaigns do you have ongoing right now?
We need a microphone.
So as we speak, CASA has a national advocacy team, which is comprised of, it's a committee essentially of representatives from our membership. And they're the ones charged with coordinating, organizing, preparing, helping to plan campaigns, and also will be the ones responsible for executing the campaigns on their campus. Right as we speak, the preparations are in place to do a wall of debt campaign that will be presented to the membership on Wednesday, next Wednesday, where they'll get the final document to go forth. And there's a whole strategy that will be laid out there that will sort of explain the process, how the execution works at the week, how we support that in the office as a home office staff is, you know, we'll help generate media releases, we'll help feed it to different local outlets. We'll put students in front of different cameras and voices. We'll help coordinate the back end, maybe the design, preparation, printing of materials. So that's sort of the current campaign we have ongoing right now for our members.
In addition to that, we also have trying to engage directly all of the board council for each of the SHRC. So that's more targeted on a grad student front, but ensuring that they're engaging with each of those council to ensure that a representative. So that's a campaign that's ongoing. For producing letters for each one of them. Additionally, I'm also, in my role, I'm going to be tasked with kind of producing our election 2015 strategy, which will start from a membership side, will start having to be started next year. And that's going to be something I bring forward to AGM, kind of like staff's proposal as to things that can be accomplished, especially with some of the neat things that Elections Canada is doing. Tying that in to a lot of very good get out the vote stuff is probably moving forward.
And just on a mini, I guess you can kind of call it a campaign, based on the recommendation that was adopted by the House of Commons Day and Committee of Finance, we sort of acted upon that. We had some ad space that was able to be taken out with the federal government, as well as media releases and a bit of a media push.
Hi. You've delved in on this in a little, in a couple different places. But I kind of wanted a bit more of a comprehensive answer. You talked about how DEI had wanted more What kind of steps and exactly what does can a individual member student have this kind of independence and kind of attempt to drive their own agenda within CASA?
So, and just on a bit of clarity for the UPEI example, because I know I just kind of mentioned it in passing. So at UPEI, they wanted to follow what it was an open spaces policy production format. So they want to be able to bring in students to generate the ideas as to where their policy priorities were going to be when their executive were going to go vote at CASA's policy and strategy event. So what we did is we crafted them an assessment as to what you could do to produce an open spaces. Here's the what would be involved for the activity side. They edited that. They wanted something that was more like personal to them, to how they developed their own internal priorities. They ended up using it both for a provincial mechanism and because they are the one of two post-secondary education institutions on their island, so they don't have a provincial organization. But they also were using, probably need a glass of water, but they also used that to select their own internal priorities. For how CASA can assist an individual association, that's the question, like when your association says, so we're lacking research in this component. Maybe that's what the DSU requires. We openly have time for our researchers to engage in that process and identifying what that issue is. We ask anybody who's presenting from a member standpoint, policy. Our member researchers are happy to provide input. They're happy to provide back and forth. They're happy to provide assistance. CASA staff makes no policy. It all has to be member generated. It all has to come from a specific member. We will provide assistance, but a member must put that forward. It's something that we will provide the assistance in that mechanism. Now, I don't know necessarily what the DSU would like to ask. That's something that the DSU has to present to me. And one of those kind of principles that CASA has on its autonomy. If I hand you research that you don't want, you're not going to use it, and it wasn't a really effective way for us to use student funds. So we need to have those inputs, have very specific requests. So engage. Oh, Michael, I'm really interested in the environmental lakes area. As a former Green Party staffer, so am I. But this is something like, where is this going? Like, so where can I find out more information? Oh, here's some places we can put some research in. Here's also some other organizations that are better at environmental policy than CASA is that can provide that capacity as well. Because being an organization that is five staff members, it's being able to maximize our credibility and our capability to generate the best stuff. And in those instances where we can't necessarily find you that, we work to finding those other organizations that currently do. And that's the kind of the situation. And it's like currently, as the DSU has full access to this as an associate member, like this is still stuff that's provided to all members equally across the board.
And just from internal mechanisms, we do have a few different avenues in which any member is able to influence CASA policy and bring forth CASA policy at any time. First off, we have a policy committee, which members can choose to be a part of and take a lead role in developing CASA policy, taking a lead role in identifying what is the organization going to focus on. Also, at our plenaries, at any of the meetings of our membership, there is always an opportunity for any member association to bring forth policy to the membership to have it adopted as standing CASA policy. So those are mechanisms that are open to all our members, and we, as office staff, support our members in that pursuit in any way we can, whether it is providing research or framing it or articulating it in the best way possible. So those are the opportunities that are available to all our members, whether they're full members or associate members.
Maybe just I don't know if really this is really a question, it could be. Just as a student, as myself, and I have quite a bit of student debt, my Nova Scotia portion of debt is considerably low compared to the grants and the different kind of funding that comes in and also awards. I'm just curious to why the federal levels, are about four times of what I owe provincially. The government, the statistic says since 95, the
you know, they haven't reduced any of the funding. However, they haven't reduced any of the costs or debt that students incur. And I, you know, considering that you guys are the federal group that we represent, well, that you represent us, I'm just curious to why that area hasn't changed.
Again, excellent question. The federal government in most provinces provides the base loan funding. As the entity that provincial systems are built on top of, what is the federal government's pot of money? So they make an assessment of, well, the federal government's providing this, I'll make a system that best represents my values on top of it. So depending on the government, so if it's OSAP, so the federal loans were already promised to the province. So they'll take the loans as part of their aid package, if that makes sense. But the bigger question, and the philosophical, like the core, the crux one here, which is the loan portfolio has been increasing dramatically over since 1995, and specifically since the major cuts from like 92, 93. Where you see in this package go is you see a situation where it's been undoubtable that education across the country has risen considerably in price. And unfortunately, we haven't found a mechanism to properly address that in its entirety. Trying to ensure those loans are as least onerous as possible has been part of that goal. So while we haven't, and in many instances, that first priority of guaranteeing access is still something that probably leads on the ensuring that it is the least costly access possible. So whereas the goal has been to get as many people into education as the federal government can, they've been providing those loans. CASA's engaged on ensuring that those loans have been hopefully as manageable as students can have them. But you're spot on. It's something we need to do better. It's something we hope that things like advocating on the grants being fixed and forever being an increasing potential portion of that pie can do better. And it's something that we hope really the DSU will work with us to continue to make it better. And I apologize that isn't better right now.
Hi, I don't mean to grill you anymore, you know, you've been here for quite a while now, but so part of the reason why the situation is as bad as it is now is because the federal government dismisses education as a provincial issue. So your approach is the federal one, and part of the solution, again, like please educate me on this, but is to get federal and provincial leaders in a room together to perhaps discuss the increase of federal, secondary post transfers, et cetera, et cetera. But essentially, how does your approach, what are you doing now, helping with that problem?
So, on the federal transfers front, we are living in an environment where the conservatives have adopted what's been an since their government came into power, a policy of, I will write you this check of this much, I attach no strings, but it's less than the checks you used to receive from a social funding side than what necessarily like a previous Liberal government might put together. So the conservatives have adopted a philosophy pretty early on that was like, I will attach no strings. And this has unfortunately meant that it's a difficult negotiating position for trying to ensure that more funding from that social transfer gets allocated post-secondary education, because an old mechanism could be the federal government just attaches a recommendation to it. But provincial autonomy is something that the conservatives have stepped up on. But as for the social transfer, like advocating for the increase of the social transfer, that's been an advocacy priority for CASA. It was there 3 years ago. It was there 4 years ago. It's something that sits on our books currently right now, and any time that question comes up in Ottawa is one that we absolutely say that more money needs to come from the federal government to the provinces, no questions asked. And it was a decision from this year's membership, from its own assessment of what political opportunity was, to not put that as one of the priorities that was going to be for this year, but it can very easily be a priority for next year. I believe that it looks like the next sets of negotiations will be just before the 2015 election.
Sorry, just to follow up to that question. When you answered my question before, you said that like there was incremental steps that had to be made. Just going back to this question, what are the incremental steps that are being made to make that a priority?
In this instance, it can be directing more money directly to students. Like, and that's working on the student aid front to ensure that no matter what that funding package is to them, that they're able to access education affordably and with protection. So these opportunities to engage on the federal government on this larger package aren't necessarily something that arises all of the time, and national priorities mean the federal government isn't talking about it all that time. It is one of those allocating resources where you think you can get a benefit at a given moment, and the membership does make that call, like as to what they want their priorities to be. From a staff on an assessment of the federal priorities, is that being able to establish those benefits right now to students is probably something that will be more achievable more quickly. Now that said, when it comes down to those major funding packages, it'll also be making sure to raise that as an important component of any any federal election, as an important component. That's one of those big asks. And that's one of those ones that the time that you have some of the most policy levers with that the federal government is at that point. And the membership will get a priority. What are the things that we want to ask the federal government for at this point? What are the things we think we can put that effort in that will ensure that education is more affordable? Now that does mean picking fights at times, and it means picking certain priorities. Is it the social transfer? Maybe that is the program that definitely wants to be pushed forward. Maybe it's a social transfer with an absolute clear-cut idea as to where post-secondary education funding as the envelope goes, and demand that the provinces have absolutely open and transparent positions on that. That could be something that is the big ask and a big priority, but it will be for a membership to decide. And not myself. We'll provide you with an assessment, but we won't say which one to pick.
Just a quick follow-up. When it comes to also what our home office staff or what resources are being put into advocacy at any given time, any standing policy on CASA's books, as a staff, we're charged with being able to act on that, if opportunities exist. If, for example, an MP or a committee wanted to sit down to discuss renegotiating the Canada social transfer, we would be at the table there with them saying, look, we have on policy, like we, as a student organization on behalf of our members, think this amount should be increased and be dedicated directly towards students and towards post-secondary education. So just because it wasn't selected necessarily on that list this year, doesn't mean that as an organization, we won't continue to advocate for it.
Apparently, you guys operate with a policy diamond, I understand. Isn't there a when you're assessing which policies to make priorities? And again, I've been told this. Thank you for clarifying that.
We changed that process this year.
Okay.
That was the previous year. And members, in fact, we received many feedback that needed to be changed. Mm-hmm. And it was something that was adjusted.
Okay, that's important to note. I don't know if political opportunities are part of your processes, but then a big criticism has been that CASA doesn't do enough to change public opinion, whether through demonstration or through active campaigns. And I mean, there's never a right political opportunity for you to reduce tuition or to do major social change. So you gotta sometimes go for a major push. So again, how does CASA address some of those larger issues?
So you had a two-pronged question there. I'll talk about the first one on the process, and then we'll talk about the activity on the large scale question. So the process, and one of the things that CASA moved away from, was something that said the political opportunity was going to be a sole assessment. We provided to each of our committees, which are made up of student representatives from each of our members, the ability on the policy committee, the ability on the advocacy committee, the ability if they're on a specific subset, so graduate students, trades and technology students, the ability to look through CASA's entire policy book and find out what their priorities were, find out places where that comes forward. And that's a place where bringing those together is where we found the opinions of all of our members. They provided their votes. They engaged in a back and forward at policy and strat. which wasn't perfect. There are things that we think we can improve on next year, and it's a process that we always work towards trying to refine. The ability to select priorities between 24 associations across the country is a difficult one. It's flat out, it's something that we continue to try to get better at, and I don't know if we're anywhere near the perfect, but it's the step-by-step to that. On the question of finding together, taking on those big challenges, one, this is the members' association. As the staff at CASA, we are the agents and the civil service at that level of advocacy. So what we would say back to the DSU and all of our members, that is the advocacy that occurs between CASA members to make a decision as to what they want to pick as a big thing and how big they want to make it. So that means, and I'll be honest, that means calling up other associations very often. That means talking, negotiating. The big things and creating big things across the country requires big buy-in. And if I tell you to do it from a staff at an office in Ottawa, I suck at it. But if you guys come together and we have all 24 associations saying, like, this priority is the one I want to do, that's real buy-in and that's real social change, because that's the grassroots component. And that's having them be able to do it at the level that is most appropriate where they come from.
Can you do that without
you then? I'm going to say, actively, if you think you can, that's something that the DSU should assess. We think that the other things that we provide as well, and the facilitation for those campaigns, we would actively support that. And we would dedicate more resources from the organization to that if that was the members' priority. But what I guess I'm saying is that our 24 members have not said, do this as a priority for us. So this is in part on our associations. Like, if you want that big active thing across the country, I'm happy to assist you in getting in contact with them all. I'm happy to make sure to get lists for you, follow up with people if you want to engage in that. But that's something that we give that autonomy to every one of our associations to make that call.
Can I get a glass of water by any chance? Sorry, guys.
Two people on it.
How
many glasses?
I would have appreciated that a lot, actually.
You partly answered my question about. I was just curious about, like, who developed the idea for elections or, like, voting across Canada or implementing something like that. Like, I don't disagree with that, but my understanding is it's just, like, the issues of education, the biggest issue is money. And then when we talk about government, it's money. And I was just curious to why, like, and I will say this about students NS as well, to why the lobby groups are branching all over the map. I mean, rather than doing one thing well and 20 things poorly, you know, and focus on what's, you know, I mean, I'm a student and it's just like what's important, right? Accessibility is about, like, for me, students with disabilities and like myself, you know, where does grant funding come from? How do you lower this debt? Like student loans programs that are like basically screwed up. Our government, it doesn't make any sense. Like part-time loans, full-time loans, like in status. There we go. So just you know, if you guys had like one, I understand you represent the constituencies and the university fund you. And I mean, if that was a university idea for the elections or somebody that paid you money, then great. Did you guys develop that on your own? You know, I'm just curious about that. So what's being represented and what's being heard? Because I hear, you know, I hear a lot of different talking and stuff like that, but I'm just like, you know, what would you, your clear goal to see? Personally, me, it's about funding, accessibility to education. For people who can actually, that don't get a chance or that, you know, that need that funding. I didn't borrow money because I didn't need it.
Thanks. Thank you very much again for that question. I guess to answer, you know, one part of your question is you will notice that everything that we've spoken about in terms of what we advocate for is directly related to post-secondary education. And that is something that our membership has kept a very narrow, as far as their concern and their involvement is with CASA. We want this organization to just pick one thing, and that is post-secondary education federal. That's the one thing. Granted, there's a lot of pieces in that, and be very good at it and be very effective with it. All the priorities you noticed or mentioned up there, I'll be the first to admit that that's a lot of priorities, a lot of priorities to push at very hard, and something, again, we continue to work with to become better at it and to become more effective with it. I'll let you touch on maybe the election part.
Yeah. On the election front, and I'll be honest, I'm coming from some of the expertise that I have, I was going to put together an option for our members at their AGM for an election campaign. It's something that it's an important time to influence policy and influence money. The times that parties provide and promise the largest chunks of money are during elections. And part of being it then is being able to influence their ability and their interest in student issues at that time and make commitments. Because that's probably some of the few times you get a really rock solid commitment from someone that it's easier to hold them accountable to. So I'll be honest, the proposal on the election is something that I was going to, like, a component staff would draft, provide it to the membership to accept or not. If they don't want to go in that direction, or they would like to amend it, it is absolutely their power and their capability to. But on the question of money, if you were looking for my staff assessment, would be the best time to get money and to get those promises from any party is during those elections. And being able to influence and have a say then can be some of the most critical time.
So, so none of the groups that fund you guys came up with the elections idea, or was that?
We were only funded by student associations.
Yeah, I know it's done by student associations, but was this a CASA idea, or was this like brought to you guys?
Here, I'll be. It was something I was going to put forward as an opportunity. Something if the membership wanted to engage in at the next AGM, and that was something that was going to be drafted as kind of an opportunity to say, like, we're this far out. It's something you probably want to think about. Here's this. If membership says not what they want to do, it will be scrapped.
Yeah, and I understand that. And I mean, you know, if an organization sometimes doesn't take initiatives to propose different ideas and stuff like that, but on the other hand, that does take resources and stuff. And sometimes when people ask for something or they're wondering what's going on or people can't understand or they're not getting enough information, you know, for goals that were previously implemented, then, you know, and obviously, like, what direction that's going in. So, I mean, you've answered my question, like, for what I had asked, so.
I think the only additional thing I would add is that from the national director, I'm provided a variety of tasks that would fall definitely within the, like, these are CASA priorities. Those are the ones I have to focus on. The graduate students and something like making sure to find a mechanism by which that they can influence representation was high on my list of things that needed to be addressed. And if that wasn't done, I wasn't working on another project. Coming out here and giving presentations is an important component of, like, my job description and something I would do as well. I would say that, and just for any organization, because everyone here will have staff at some point, certainly respecting a bit of their initiative and seeing places where they might have capacity to create other new things. But I would hear, and I commit to you, I would never let it imperil the commitments that I've held to by CASA's membership.
Maybe anyone who has a question can raise their hand, and then we'll cap it at that. Two more questions, and I'll
call it. Just from your internal perspective, what is CASA's weakest point, and how have you guys been actively trying to correct that and make it better for future years?
I think the boss gets to answer this one.
First. I would say right now, and when I'm still, would say towards the end of transitioning into my role. Right now, one of our weak points is I believe we could do more on the research and being a thought leader in the field of post-secondary education. Frankly, we can be contributing a lot more as an organization to the federal landscape, and to be a voice and continue to produce high-quality research that can be interpreted, digested, can be passed around to the members to look at, to provide their input based on what's happening on their campuses, and then be turned into, again, good quality reports and research that will last into the future. And maybe we might not get picked up by this government, but it might get picked up in a platform somewhere else. So I would say if I've identified one weakness that as the head of the organization that I'm looking to do and to commit towards is that.
So as you know, probably, I'm here on behalf of the Dalhousie Association of Graduate Students, and the Dalhousie portion of graduate students is 20% or approximately 3,700 graduate students on campus at Dal. And a lot of the work that you said, that you mentioned that you do, is advocating at a national level. And I was just wondering if you could sort of elaborate as to the importance or perhaps the scope of the national work that you do, and perhaps why an organization like ourselves, things that we can't do for graduate students that you can and you have done. So
I think we'll both kind of address this one. The Ottawa process, and I think that's something that's up there, is one that is pretty complicated. And Ottawa only really accepts a certain kind of input into many of the civil service elements, into many of the strategic formation elements, that is very much based on kind of a stakeholder model. So something where they find organizations that represent large groups of or others, and they're able to talk to them directly. Generally speaking, when it's a consultation on student loans, they do not talk to single associations. They don't talk to single universities. They talk to the AUCC. They go to that body. They don't really want to hear from specific, because when you're talking at the national level, and this is unfortunately kind of a blind spot at the national level, they'll go, well, there's a million students in Canada. How many do you represent? Well, that's nice. And they just don't engage at that. They don't make the calls out to come over all the way to Halifax for a consultation on something like service provision. And unfortunately, they won't even let you know it's happening. They won't let you know that SHRC is changing the talent program because, well, they're just going to go do that assessment. And their criteria for making that is they need to engage with stakeholders, but that usually means four or five associations in Ottawa who they feel are the most charged in that capacity. So I would say that the difference being, and kind of on a broader scale, in Halifax, you have about seven MPs within direct contact. Government and the finance minister is half a country away and represents a riding in Toronto, and you've lost a lever by which you can engage with him if you don't have an organization that represents the whole country. You lose out on a lever that you can engage with someone like Jason Kenney at Economic Skills Development Canada, because he's got a riding in Alberta right now, which he's going to be focused on. He'll have a side question like, students in Alberta matter to me. Part of that alliance component is that you gain from that reach that other associations bring to you. Because you are saying, myself and the University of Calgary are friends, we both can stand here today and talk to you from a riding point of view. So we're both your constituents. We're also students from across the country, and not just a small window. And unfortunately, the federal government does look at a single institution that way. There are hundreds of institutions across the country that can be colleges. And that's also another thing, is that when political tides turn, and sometimes like a discussion that's going on right now, is that something like colleges and polytechnics have the ear of many policymakers in Ottawa. So what that means is that to get student loan benefits, if you're able to represent a group that has all of those brought in, it's better able to bring out that capacity to you, because you're able to say, I represent and work with students from every group. Students across the board want this assistance.
That means it benefits undergraduates, and for a graduate association, it could be the same capacity, as it brings that research that when funding is increased to SHRC or something, that's going right. That also has a direct an application side, so that might be going to State Polytechnic. Making those deals and being able to have that common identity helps moving forward. And unfortunately, the federal government, many times may not even consider Nova Scotia in a policy that it's developing. And that's why the benefit is having a national organization that brings something forward.
I'll just add one other quick piece, just to complement what you said. And there are, at times, whether it's consultations with stakeholders or some of those groups, or even the odd consultation with the government, is that you know they want to speak. Then in that case, sometimes they do want to speak to students directly. And a lot of the times, at least we see, their mechanism of accessing and speaking through those students is through a national organization such as ours. And they'll come forth. For just I'll give like two quick examples. One, the Conference Board of Canada, you know, one of the leading research think tanks in the country, is doing their Center for Post-Secondary Skills and Education, which again create high-level policy, national vision for post-secondary education in Canada. They've reached out to our organization. At times, we provide our consultation and feedback. But they also said, we want to speak to some students. Which students can you put us in touch with? And we go and we scan our membership, and we scan who's part of our organization, and again, pair them up with that. One of the consultation groups with the Canada Student Loans Program, again, for the service delivery piece, they, you know, we are no longer students. We don't access student loans. We can't be that familiar with that. With the current mechanism or website or what have you. So again, they ask us to put four names of students to participate in those consultations, and we provide them to do that.
I guess as a final kind of closing to that one, I guess I'd have an example. My question would be, what I'd ask everyone in the room, what consultation was occurring last week that impacted post-secondary education? Unfortunately, that's the way the federal government works. There was a science, tech, and innovation commitment. We circulated that in our member emails that we hope that members are able to distribute as widely, and we encourage them to share them as widely as possible to allow individual associations to have a say on this policy as well, because it's somewhere where they were looking for that. This kind of stuff is part of it is metabolizing what the federal government does and being able to provide you with those kind of access. And part does require a bit of translation because the federal government's kind of weird. Just kind of happens that way. Oh, yeah, just, guys, first off, super thank you for staying with us till like 9:30. And fantastic questions, like really insightful. It's something we really appreciate from our doing our own jobs, is being able to have that direct engagement to ask those really interesting things and to see where potentially new opportunities occur. I think John and I will both say, like, we live in Ottawa. There's a reason it's called an Ottawa bubble, and it's a reason I talk sometimes in acronyms. Like, that's what happens, and this is an incredibly important part, and we hope that the DSU continues to bring that, and we very much hope that during your assessment of CASA's organization, that this has been informative. We're happy to answer more questions, but we really do look forward to having a long and extended relationship with the DSU. The DSU has played an incredibly important leadership role in CASA for its entire existence, and has continued to bring incredibly new ideas through every delegate that they have brought forward. And so we very much hope to continue to have that chance to work with you in the future.
Thanks again, guys. Just before everyone leaves, I just want to wrap up by quickly explaining the process moving forward. If people remember, the advocacy review process started back last spring in March when we passed a motion to drop down to associate membership of CASA. Since then, the committee has been meeting and produced a report after consultations and whatnot. There was some concern expressed by students in Nova Scotia about some of the process, and we're sorry for that miscommunication. They were notified that this was an advocacy review meeting, but we thought it was a council meeting, so that there was going to be a vote on the housing report right after discussion, so there was a bit of confusion, but we said that we'd offer them the opportunity to come back. This discussion is definitely ongoing, there's a website, advocacy or dsu.ca/advocacy-review, where we'll have this video up. We'll have websites, emails, and any other like reports. We got lots more time to talk with this lots more, but thanks everyone for coming.
Thank you guys so much.
More snow, please.
Yeah. We could fly it on time tomorrow.
Yeah, when do you guys leave?
10:55.
Thanks a lot. You should have said that you gave up your first class seats for Dogger Night.
Oh.